and welcome to the Pebble Beach Concours d'Elegance. So we're coming to you live from the lawn of the lodge at Pebble Beach. The 65th Concours d'Elegance at Pebble Beach coming at you from the beautiful Monterey Peninsula in California. With me on the desk today for the next 4 hours is Johnny Lieberman and Ed Lowe. Gentlemen, welcome. Had a good day so far?
Yeah, so far.
What have you seen?
About 220 beautiful cars.
So you were at the Dawn Patrol this morning?
No, not this year. Okay. I slept in because of this.
Okay, so a lot going on here over the next 4 hours. We'll be looking at a lot of the cars and a lot of the people who are here at the Concours d'Elegance. But first, maybe we should have a bit of an overview of the event. What is a Concours d'Elegance all about?
Well, it's a very highly curated event, a car show. But unlike the one at the Bob's Big Boy, this is invite only. They plan this for years and years in advance. They try and get the very creme de la creme, the best of the best of the best, stick them on the lawn, and then judge them. And one of these cars will be named the best of show. There's also a lot of classes, and they're going to be a bunch of class winners, a couple awards. But the real event is what's the best car on the lawn.
And it's more than a fancy car show. I mean, the people here really invest. This is their livelihood. They put a lot of their passion is on display here. It's not just maybe the average car in somebody's garage. You know, their third fun little runabout. Right. They're millions and millions of dollars invested in the vehicles and in the care and restoration.
I think it's interesting. I mean, it's not a contest of speed, but of elegance. So the vehicles are judged for their historical accuracy and historical merit, technical merit, but they're also judged for their style, and that's a really subjective element, and I think that's where a little bit of controversy comes in.
Yeah, I mean, again, I was talking to a bunch of people on the lawn. What's your favorite versus what do you think's going to win? Because the key is the elegance part, and like something else, you know it when you see it. And I was talking to somebody, and they said their favorite was, I like the Fiat, the Abarth, or I like the 8V. And I said, yeah, but is it elegant enough to win? And we'll see. Right. I have my idea who's going to win, but we'll see.
Now, the Pebble Beach Concours was first held in 1950 in conjunction with the very first Pebble Beach Road Race, and there were only two or three dozen cars in three classes. It was really simple back then. You had pre-war cars, you had post-war cars, you had MGs, which is kind of interesting, I guess, reflects how important MGs were in post-war America.
Once upon a time. Yeah, hey, soldiers coming back from the war, they wanted something fun to drive and relatively inexpensive, and yeah, it was huge. I mean, Carroll Shelby's first race car was an MG. MGC, I believe.
A lot of American racing stars got their starts in MGs. It's interesting to reflect now that the brand's owned by the Chinese and building cars in China.
Right.
I think we're going to see a lot of, as we go through some of the cars that come up on the ramp today, just how the automotive world has changed. Now, the Concours moved to its current location here at the Lodge in 1952, and in 1955, Phil Hill showed a 1931 Pierce Arrow, and it became the first pre-war car to win Best of Show at Concours, and it set a tradition that's really endured for most of the past 65 years.
Right, there's been two post-war cars that have won. There's a Maserati, is that correct?
In 1968, a 1964 Maserati Mistral won Best of Show. And, of course, last year.
Of course, last year. Yes, the Ferrari. Yes.
Did you call that one?
No. I called the Hispano Suiza from 1931. That came in second place.
Right. Close. So close.
Yeah.
Well, that was an interesting win last year with that car. And we'll probably talk more about that later on. Ferrari, of course, one of the favored marks at Pebble Beach. There are certain marks that have a real history there. Ferrari's one of them. This Pebble Beach, this has been long established as the world's top Concours d'Elegance. And the whole idea of a Concours d'Elegance started back in the 1920s and 30s, where there were sort of impromptu car shows, and bodybuilders and proud owners would bring their cars out and and display them. And some of the special body cars we've seen here, that we'll see here today, were built for Concours d'Elegance events back in the 1930s. But it's really shifted. The emphasis has shifted from, you know, showing cars that are built today to cars of yesterday. Really,
it's interesting that more places don't aspire. Around the world, aspire to a Concours-like experience. I mean, this is, you talk to everybody here, fantastic event. This is the premier place for these kinds of vehicles, this kind of luxury and enjoyment. And it's odd, I was talking to a couple of automotive execs about, you know, why here? Why isn't anyone else trying to do this? You know, and apparently, I guess, Paris, they're going to try to do one on the Champs-Élysées. At this level, you know, there are smaller ones, there's Amelia, there's other places, but I mean, it's weird to me that no one else tries to go for it like Pebble Beach.
I mean, the Champs-Élysées and right here, location, this True. Is, it adds a lot to it. But, you know, a dear friend of mine, this is his first time coming for the entire week, and I saw him at the Ferrari house the other day, and I said, what do you think? And he said, you know, I didn't really believe you, how much fun it was, and now I'm never going to miss it again. Right. And it's that sort of event. I remember the first time I came, I didn't really understand what I was getting myself into. That was 9 years ago, I think, and this is my ninth year. So.
Well, I think, you know, as a car enthusiast, this is one of the must-see events on your calendar. And if you get the opportunity to come and attend Pebble Beach Automotive Week, really, because it's more than just the Concours. This is the finale to almost a week now of celebration and car events.
Right.
So this event and Goodwood Festival of Speed are right up there on the calendar of must-sees if you want to see some of the greatest cars in the world
yes.
up close
yes,
and personal.
Absolutely.
Literally the greatest cars in the world.
Right. Well, you know, I wished I'd been here in 1985. They had all six Bugatti Royales together. I think it was the first time in history these cars, the most expensive cars ever built, all six of them were together on the lawn here at Pebble Beach.
Because that never happened at the Bugatti factory at Molsheim. That never happened.
No.
Now, last year they had 216 cars and motorcycles here, 35 which have came from outside the United States. And the event raised over $1.6 million for charity. Charitable donations are a big part of the whole Pebble Beach event, the Pebble Beach Concours. The total donations from the Concours over the years is more than $19 million.
Right.
And invitation-only event, as we talked, you have to be invited to show your car here. And there are 220 cars, I think, on the lawn this year. It's interesting, too, if you win your class here, I believe you're not allowed to bring that car back for 10 years, which kind of keeps the collector...
Really? What if you win Best of Show? There's a couple of Best of Show winners.
But it won 9 or 10 years ago.
It won in 2008. Alfa Romeo.
But that's a special class, I think. That's a.
Yeah, you probably. You know, there is.
And it might be 7 years. We should know this. Ed's right. There's that beautiful blue Alfa. I mean, the dash to axle for a mile.
Yeah.
That was Best of Show in 2008. I mean, it's a 2900 special bodied car and. Just incredible.
Yeah.
Just incredible. Fantastic.
So we talked about it briefly, Pebble Beach Automotive Week, more than just the Concours event. The McCall's Motorworks Revival event, also known as the Hangar Party, is the Wednesday night traditional kickoff, and always an interesting event to get to at Monterey Airport, eclectic collection of cars.
Cars and airplanes.
One of the big
manufacturers showing there was Acura. They brought out their NSX supercar. Also the Honda Jet, $4 million short hop executive jet. Fantastic airplane. Perfect place to show it because apparently they sold one at that event. Because you can get up close to it, touch it, walk around inside it. I mean, for this level of clientele, you don't really have that opportunity to do it. Again, it's such a luxurious location around a lot of your friends and also seeing some very beautiful cars. An amazing party, a great way to kick off. I feel like Wednesday is really the big kickoff for all the stuff this week.
And McCall's, what I think is really cool about it is the diversity of that show is kind of unrivaled. Because when you get further down the week, it starts to break up. You have quails like motorsports focused. You have the Legends of the Autobahns, Germany, Concorso Italiano's, Italian cars. Last year, they had the first Bentley chassis ever was there. And John Hennessy had his 270-mile-an-hour Venom thing. And everything in between. And this year was the GM Futureliner. It's an incredible mix, and I love eclectic events like that. And this year it was twice as large as it was last year. Right. So
that's one of the problems actually for the whole Pebble Beach Automotive Week is that it just keeps growing. And you know, if you look at some of the events, there's really running out of places to put all these cars. You can't walk around the Monterey Peninsula without tripping over a Ferrari or a Shelby or a Porsche. It's amazing.
But in that way, it's fantastic because there are all of these very exclusive events with, you know, eye-watering ticket prices. You know, this is one of them. But if you love cars, you don't necessarily have to just come here. I see kids all over the place, car-crazy kids with cameras hanging out in the parking lot. They're getting up early. They're standing by the roadside as the cars come zipping
by.
They're
bringing lights. They figured out you can go to the hotels and sneak into the covered carports, and they bring lights with batteries.
Right.
And they do their own photo shoots.
There's arguably a better car show of modern super sports cars in the parking lot at the lodge right now than you'll see anywhere else in the world. I mean, McLaren P1s, you'll see, Enzo Ferraris.
Veyrons.
Veyrons, 4, 5, 6, 7 Veyrons.
The other kickoff event, is the Tour d'Elegance.
Oh, yes. And
which we got to participate in.
We did.
Quite a thrilling event. But when they pull onto Ocean Avenue in Carmel, that's free.
Right.
And it's a lot of these cars are there. And, what a show.
Well, the Tour d'Elegance is important because the cars that take part in that are cars that are judged here on the lawn. And in the event of a close-run decision among the judges as to who's going to win a place or best of class, it could come down. The deciding factor could be whether you took part in the Tour d'Elegance.
Right, so it becomes the tiebreaker.
We had some cars on that tour, which was a 90-mile drive down from here, the lodge, down Highway 1 over the iconic Bixby Bridge built in 1932. Cars that were are widely tipped to be best of show contenders were on that. And I was lucky enough to drive a modern car, the Mercedes-AMG GTS, Mercedes-Benz, of course, being a big sponsor of a lot of events here at Pebble Beach. And Johnny, you got a...
I was much luckier than you. Yeah, I got to ride in and then later drive the C111, which is sitting out on the lawn right now in the Mercedes class. And that's that orange fiberglass mid-engine Mercedes supercar that they never built, which started life as a rotary. They decided, let's put a V8 in there. And I drove with Michael Bach, your buddy, mm-hmm. who's head of Mercedes Classic Center.
I was jealous of your drives until I remember that last year I got to drive the Mille Miglia in a 1955 300 SL, 1,000 miles.
Let's stay focused on Pebble Beach.
Okay, but there's a lot going on here. Makes every car enthusiast drool. But that C111, amazing. And I love that Mercedes has their Classic Center staff out here, and unlike a lot of the cars, they're letting people get in, take pictures with it, sit, drive it, because it's a museum car. It's not a privately owned vehicle.
Well, that's hugely important, and the very smart automakers are all here, because this is where people and cars connect. And just looking out at the crowd here at on the lawn here at the lodge at Pebble Beach, it's an opportunity to for car people to come together and experience cars that perhaps they wouldn't have the chance to do that. And Mercedes-Benz knows, and other automakers know too, that even if kids come and look at those cars, they're building fans and enthusiasts for the future who in 10, 15, 20 years' time might be able to afford to buy one of their more exotic cars.
And truly, the people out on the lawn, this is really passion on display here, not just the vehicles themselves, but some of these people here who are right up against the stage, they set up their blankets and their chairs at 4:30 a.m. in the morning to get that prime position, pole position, if you will. Why? because they love the vehicles, they love this event. I mean, it's awesome.
So the one of the other events, and one that we enjoy going to, is of course the Quail on Friday, and it's a very different sort of show from this one. A lot more racing cars and a lot more later models, really. It's if you're into 50s and 60s cars, 70s cars.
But even newer, I mean, there was four Ferrari F50s just kind of sitting in their own
four or group. Five, I lost count.
I saw four. Then there was that wonderful row where they had these, you know, the 88 Aston Martin V8 Vantage, the Jag XJ220, and on, there's Countaches. And then there was like that barn find basket case 356, the 1952 Porsche.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Unbelievable, unrestored Tijuana interior, you know, the blanket, like out of Pulp Fiction, you know, fabulous. And that was my favorite car, I think. You know, it was just incredible.
And you talked earlier about how these events, it's almost getting, we're at the limit here, but a lot of people said the Quail was very much improved over last year. They moved things around. It felt a little more open.
They also doubled the size of the lawn.
Right.
That helped a lot.
Helped
and
a
they
lot.
Raised the ticket price.
Sure.
But the Quail is an event where the new automakers really really come on board. So, you know, Acura had three examples of the new NSX there. A red one, which was the show car color launch. They had a black one and then one in a really vivid metallic blue. Looks spectacular in the sunlight. Audi was there, Land Rover was there, Mercedes-Benz. Everybody.
Rolls-Royce presenting Michael Fuchs with his annual car.
Yes, Michael Fuchs, a great personality here at Pebble Beach every year with his custom colored cars.
That's his ninth custom Rolls-Royce.
It's amazing. And I, you know, the guy's enthusiasm and passion, the cars may not be to everyone's taste,
sure.
But he has a singular vision and he pursues it. And it is quite something to see a metallic purple Rolls-Royce Phantom drophead coupe with snow-white leather interior.
Well, and you think about it, what is crazy to us now, 50 years, his collection will probably be out here on the lawn and people will talk about it. It'll be in the book. It'll say when this came out.
Part of the Fuchs collection.
Right.
It might be his own class.
Right. He'll have his style will be evident and we'll be talking about it.
The Rolex Monterey Motorsports Reunions runs for three or four days over the weekend, and it's a completely different flavor of the old car scene too. Classic racing cars, and they get in them and they drive them, they race them. So it's a great few days.
Right, for the purists, for some, it's the whole reason to come out here. It's not necessarily
cars parked on a golf course.
Cars parked on a lawn. I mean, I like that. You know, one of the stipulations for this Concours is that the car has to, you know, get out there in its own power, and it's got to start up and move for the judges, and they mechanically sound, but totally different from what's going on at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca, where the cars are really door handle to door handle like racing, and there's some wrecks, but there's a lot of ego on the line there. You
that
know?
When I first started coming to this, that was the one that blew me away because okay, there's a Ferrari 250 GTO, and I've read about it since I can remember. One sold in Japan in the 80s for $20 million. You know, one sold last year for $38 million, and there it is on a racetrack.
Right.
And there's other cars with it, and they're, you know, they're moving it. So I couldn't believe it. And then, you know, you get to hear the sounds like Trans Am cars. I always read about Trans Am cars, watch them when I could on TV. They're actually running,
right?
You know, and Can-Am and F1 and every cool class of race car.
They change it up every year. There's always something different every year, so that you can, you know, enjoy. I mean, I grew up reading about the Can-Am cars in Australia, and to see, you know, one of the massive 8-liter McLaren M8s
with the trumpets
and bright orange and thundering. I was lucky enough many, many years ago to co-drive in the inaugural Targa Tasmania with the late, great Denny Holm. And, of course, Denny drove McLaren Grand Prix cars as well as the Can-Am cars. And he told me the McLaren Can-Am car, the last iteration of that car, was, in his opinion, the best racing car he ever drove.
That's funny because we were at Amelia Island, which is another great Concours event. I was having dinner with Jochen Maas, who's with Angus and I on the Tour d'Elegance, and we were asking him, okay, come on, what's the best race car? What's the best race car? And he said, well, you know, there's the 956 is very good, the Porsche 962, and he's going, and then all of a sudden it hit him. He said, oh, the 917.
Right.
He He said, that car, he said, you know, wheels spin at 200 miles an hour. He said it was, there's nothing else like it.
Something about racing drivers, that cars like that really get your attention.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you talk to guys who've driven old Formula 5000 cars, and they say, you know, and to get at 160 miles an hour, wheel spins so violent that it blurs your vision, kind of gets your attention.
Right. Yeah. So, anyway, that's a very cool event, Maserati.
But what about another good event to go to too, Concorso Italiano? And it really does what it says on the tin, doesn't it?
If you like red Ferraris, right, there's no better place to be the planet.
Yellow Lamborghinis, right?
Or the Skittles of Lamborghinis, yeah. Right. But Ferrari 308s, Ferrari F40s in red.
It's kind of neat how after events like McCall's Motorworks and the Quail, where it's kind of everything by Friday, Saturday, you start to fragment. You have Concorso, all Italian cars. You have Legends of the Autobahn, all German cars. You know, you have obviously the racing at the track, all race cars, full running. It's very cool. And again, every single one of those parking lots is its own car show. You know,
well, the Quail parking lot. We skipped over that, but I was wandering out. Oh, look, there's a P1. There's a McLaren P1 in the parking lot.
Oh, I have a shot of it was like a Ferrari 288, and then I was looking at the picture and frame of my iPhone. And in the background is a 959, a Porsche 959.
So I was like, in the parking lot.
In the parking lot.
And so you missed it.
No, well, I walked over, took the reverse picture, where I have a 959 and then a, you know, 288.
The Pebble Beach Automotive Week just keeps on growing, doesn't it? We talked about Legends of the Autobahn, which actually started as a BMW Concours, and now it's graduated into all German car show.
And not only that, our own Jason Camisa entered his E30 Touring, that's his station wagon, and he got third place in his class.
I know. I followed the saga on Facebook as he cleaned every
100 hours with a toothbrush.
Yeah, that's a little bit obsessive, but nothing compared to what some of the cars have been doing here. I mean, you see, I park in the underground parking structure here at the lodge, and there are guys there working on the cars that are going to be real contenders there. And the cars look spotless anyway. You can't imagine what they're finding that they need to clean. But, you know, the attention to detail or the attention the judges give to these cars is amazing. Perhaps at the other end of the spectrum, one of the events here that's interesting, the Concours de Lemons. Johnny, one of your favorites.
Well, you know, as a former Lemons employee, I was part of the Lemons Supreme Court, one of the two head judges for many years. It has a very special place in my heart. I sadly didn't make it this year. I had to go drive a Ferrari, but
set it up. I mean, it's for people who don't understand. Like, the Concours here is all about beautiful, period correct, you know, fantastically expensive vehicles. It's not quite fair to say Concours is the exact opposite, right?
It's the exact opposite.
That's okay.
Well, it says on their website, in fact, that the Concours de Lemons celebrates the oddball, the mundane, and the truly awful of the automotive world.
And what's great is it's a wonderful counterpunch to this, because while this is amazing, an amazing collection of cars, the best in the world, it is easy to take it too seriously. And so it's nice that Lemons can kind of remind you that they're cars and they're fun. And I think it was 5 years ago, I was here with Bentley, and they gave me a Mulsanne, a $300,000 Mulsanne, and I entered it, and I won second worst of show. The worst of show was a Pontiac Aztec with one of the tent coming off the back. So it's a great show. It's a great show.
Well, you know, and they've got some great categories in the show too. Here you might have post-war closed touring cars or whatever. They've got Rust Belt American Junk or Unmitigated Gall, which is for French cars.
Right.
Or Rueful Britannia with electrics by Lucas, the Prince
of
Darkness.
That was the category the Bentley was in.
So there's a couple of special classes at this year's Concours d'Elegance. Every year they highlight some, and there's a few to watch. So one of them, of course, Lincoln Continental's 75th anniversary this year. And the first Lincoln to be called a Continental was, in fact, designed in 1938 as a custom car for Edsel Ford.
Right.
And it was based on a VE12 Lincoln Zephyr. Rumor has it that the car was so well received they pretty much decided to put it into production. And it debuted in 1941, so celebrating 75 years of an iconic brand name in America.
Right, and a good time to celebrate, because Lincoln is bringing back a production Continental, which they've showed and
at the New York show.
The New York show, and it's actually out on the concept car lawn. It's, it,
We didn't talk about the concept lawn.
Right. out here behind all of the festivities is a small putting green area that every year is transformed into the concept car lawn for a collection of all the various manufacturers, large and small, custom. They bring vehicles that usually in the last 3 or 4 years have been released, and people can get up close and take pictures with them. It's a phenomenal collection every year, and it's another one of these great like free events you can go and just take in.
So Mercedes-Benz is also a special class this year, and I'm looking very much forward to seeing the fabulous 300 SLR and the W196 Grand Prix car. Just two of my absolute favorite cars in the world.
I think it's a little easy to predict the winner of this class, but right. You know,
but there's some great Mercedes-Benz cars in there too. And we're just starting to hear the trumpets and fanfares as the show proceedings are beginning to get underway here at Pebble Beach. A couple more classes that we'll be looking out for among the special classes. Ferraris in the Pebble Beach road races. And this class will celebrate Ferraris that raced right here at Pebble Beach. And this is one of them, a lovely little 166M Barchetta. You look at these cars, Johnny, you can't realize how tiny they really were until you stand next to them.
Oh, they're small. And what's so cool is that they recreated the race the other day. Yeah. You know.
So getting out of the car is the son of America's first Formula One world champion, Derek Hill. Derek's going to be the master of ceremonies here at Pebble Beach for all the crowd who have come here and waited since 5 o'clock this morning, some of them, to see these fabulous cars come across the ramp.
Yep. Derek's a great guy. Follows me on Instagram. I follow him on Instagram. He's a car guy through and through, as you would expect.
That's great.
And one of the other categories that we're going to be looking at, special one, designs by Carrozzeria Touring, their super leggera bodywork, some fabulous cars, founded in Milan, Italy in 1926 and stopped producing cars in 66, but what a run that 40 years was.
And that was what we were talking about before, the Alfa Romeo, the 2900, the one best of show, was a touring car, and it's this deco masterpiece, absolutely stunning.
Fantastic.
Another great category that's going to be one of the special categories here is Cunningham's. And you read up on Briggs Cunningham, it's sort of like he was the all-American sportsman of style in an era when that really meant something. He was sort of like Ernest Hemingway with real manners and very polite.
And I've heard that. He's supposed to be a very mild manner, but he had one of the greatest chins, just chisel. And the cars are incredible. And I was lucky, I was just walking by them and they were firing them up, you know, for the judges to hear the engines. If you like V8s, Cunningham's are kind of where it's at. Just unbelievable.
Well, Bob Lutz, who we all know very well, of course, storied career in the car industry and finished his career at GM, but he had a Cunningham in his garage that was absolutely fabulous. He used to jump in that anytime he couldn't go for a speed. It was great. And then there's one of I'm looking forward to, one of the special classes here is the Mercury Customs, kind of near and dear to us at Motor Trend, actually, these cars, because at least two of the cars here are on the cover of Motor Trend magazine back in the 50s.
Yeah, there's the 49 done by Sam Barris. It was the first of that era, of the 49 to 51 Mercs, to receive the chop top treatment, which... It was wildly popular, you know, kicked off the hot rod craze really for that vehicle, and was ended up modified in beautiful green on the cover of the 1951 December issue of Motor Trend in a Winter Wonderland cover. It was fantastic. It was absolutely amazing.
And I like this class for another reason, and Ed and I can maybe relate to this a little bit more than you, but, you know, that's a Southern California class.
Yeah.
That's part of this amazing Southern California car culture, and it's wonderful to see these Mercury hot rods parked 20 feet from the Ferrari racing cars.
Right.
So I love it, and they're all beautiful.
And I love that one of them was the hero car in Stallone's Cobra.
Yes.
So we just saw Pebble Beach Concours Chairman Emeritus Jay Hoyman escorted out of the Alfa Romeo and up into the stand, and I think we're now waiting for the chairman of the Pebble Beach Concours d'Elegance, Sandra Button. Of course, Sandra's contribution to this event has been amazing. She's been chairman of the event for the past 13 years, and I think she's been involved with classic cars for 30 years.
She's phenomenal, and to be involved that long and still, you know, be able to smile on the day of this event and just be so gracious to everybody. I mean, there's so many competing personalities and egos here, and she has to balance them all.
She's still working. I saw her and her husband. They were walking by some of the Ferraris, and there's a blank, and she just goes, "There's one missing. What's missing? Why isn't it here?" She wants this to be a perfect event.
We've been at several events with her. She's at Mercedes-Benz dinner. I mean, she's just fantastic in the support of all facets of this week.
Coming up, of course, in a fantastic Cunningham.
You can hear that. This sounds amazing.
It does sound amazing.
It's a beautiful car.
So, yes, and Sandra, on the tour with husband Martin in that massive Bentley.
Bentley, oh.
I don't know how they got that around some of those corners. I mean, it was 22 feet long, that car.
Well, there was that Duesenberg that was probably 23 feet. That was massive.
Yeah, that's a fabulous car, that truly fabulous car, the Cunningham Italian design, American soul. Wonderful, wonderful car. One of the other special categories we've got here, of course, is the Shelby GT3 50th anniversary celebration. The original Ford Mustang changed the world. It was the first car designed for specifically for baby boomers, because we were all coming of age after in early 1960s, and some very prescient person at Ford, and Lee Iacocca had a hand in this, thought that they needed a car that would appeal to them. But it looked sporty. It wasn't really sporty, though, was it?
No, not at all. In fact, if you go back to that era, I think a lot of people have grown up on the mythology of Mustang. When they actually get one to work on, they're sort of horrified. Just shocked at how slow it is, how a little bit of a roll, a little bit of a softer chassis. But the cars we're talking about here, they don't suffer from that kind of performance.
They got up and moved.
Yeah. These are very, very special cars. Some fantastic, obviously, you know, super high quality restorations, and a couple of very special versions, including the Hertz models.
Right. So the Hertz was a rent a racer. That was the Shelby. You could go down to Hertz, and it was like $9 a day or something, and you could rent a real Shelby.
Right.
And what was funny was a lot of those was guys would rent them, steal the engines, take the base Mustang V8, put it in. So if it's an actual Hertz with the numbers matching engine, that's pretty rare. My favorite, I don't think it's going to win, but it's such an oddball, is a vinyl topped one.
Yep.
Oh, yes.
And the story was that it was the very first, I think the serial number is 001, it was the very first 1966 Shelby. Carol takes one look at it, says something much less polite than, "Oh, hell no." And that's it. There's never another one. But there is a Shelby with a vinyl roof. I mean, it's very American, very American.
And again, another class that's close to us at Motor Trend, because you know, Carol Shelby had a great relationship with Bob Peterson, Peterson Publishing, Hot Rod and Motor Trend founder. They were personal friends, and you know, I was lucky enough to go to lunch a couple of times with Carol Shelby, and he was quite a character. Some of the stories he told, a lot of them unrepeatable in polite company, but just an amazing character. And he had a real soft spot for us at Motor Trend, and we would always get a first look at any hot new car he was doing. And even well into his 80s, you put him in a car, he'd just put his foot down, and he never slowed down.
And we still have so much of his legacy that's gone undiscovered. You know, after he passed, when we put together our special, we were unearthing footage, you know, videos and photos that had never been seen before, including one of him, Carol, carving his initials into a tree. CS wearing like a red cowboy hat. It's fantastic.
Well, you know, we do have, you know, such amazing archives in the at Motor Trend with some of those photos from the 50s and 60s. As we watch the honorary judges come out and starting to introduce them now, a lot of people here we know. The first guy out. Akim Anscheid, who is the design director at Bugatti, and he's got an interesting task ahead of him. They are doing a new sports car to follow up on the Veyron. rumored to be faster and more powerful, if you can believe that. I mean, the Veyron Grand Sport and Super Sport's 1,200 horsepower car, 268 mile an hour top speed. It's going to be a tough act to top.
It's also rumored to be kind of done and showing up soon in secret. They're kind of, it's going to be a secret tour around key markets. So, yeah.
It's probably there.
There he is, yes, son of a triple motorcycle world champion, Akimacha. Valentino Balboni, the man who had the best job in the world. He was Lamborghini's test driver for decades.
Yeah.
A cool guy, too.
I was lucky enough I got to go in a Valentino Balboni. They named a Lamborghini after him, and he drove me around in it. And it was one of the most memorable drives of my life. It was really magical.
Chris Bangle, I have a very high opinion of Chris. I think the most influential designer of the early 21st century. We had a lot of controversy with his BMW designs, but they were really innovative and far-reaching.
He was right, that's what you can say, because everyone then copied what he did.
Well, the interesting thing about, one of the interesting innovations that Chris pioneered was the undercut body side, and you see everyone doing that, as well as the raised trunk lid, which there was an aerodynamic benefit in that, but a very, I think history will judge him as a very influential. Great friend of ours out now there, Derek Belg. Great guy. We've all ridden with Derek. Great raconteur, great storyteller.
And our friend Justin's father.
Yeah. Dr. Luke Betts, of course. We've worked with him at Aston Martin. Great visionary. Turned the company around. His VH architecture cars, terrific.
Yeah, they're still in production.
They are still in production. And they only now just starting to reinvent that brand. Oh, Michael Buck, your driver.
My co-driver, yes. Michael's a very nice guy. And we were looking at Porsche 930 Turbos that he was thinking about buying. So.
Oh,
Meech is really cool. He penned the Panamera wagon concept.
Yes.
So young guy, watch him. Keep your eye on him.
Well, and that car, a lot of that DNA, that car's going to appear in the next generation Panamera, which is going onto a new platform architecture that will be shared with Bentley's Continental and Flying Spur. Tom Bryant, of course, an old colleague of ours, many, many years editor-in-chief of Road and Track.
I worked under him for about a year. It's fantastic. I mean, you talk about an old-school technique. I mean, just the way to build a magazine with him. And he had the best collection of Art Deco car models I've ever seen. It was fantastic.
Ian Callum, of course, a good friend of ours, and hopefully will come and join us later in the day.
Absolutely.
Here on the desk. Ian loves coming here, loves cars. Great guy to talk to.
As long as we don't beat him up on the details. He just wants to talk about the cars he wants to talk about.
Mercury Customs.
Chris Chapman. Now, that Hyundai show car, the big coupe, the HCD60, I saw that last night on the lawn here at Pebble. It's a really good piece of work, a really extravagant coupe.
Wayne Cherry.
Stands out. Oh, Wayne Cherry, yeah. Former Car of the Year judge.
Yep. Good friend of ours.
Fourth head of design for GM, I believe.
Yes.
Welburn's fifth, yeah.
His Cadillac 16 is one of the best concept cars ever done, I thought.
For automotive research in Naples and the founding supporter of the Stanford Revs Initiative.
Stanford Revs, it's the big program over here at Stanford University. They've taken in a lot of these PhD in cars. You can pick up, they picked up a lot of the archives of different publishing houses, and they're basically kind of opening them up for the public to research and use. So it's a great program.
Wolfgang, another good friend of ours, chairman of Bentley and Bugatti, has one of the best jobs in the business. He's also very, very passionate, very attention to detail oriented. He knows what he wants, and he works hard to make sure everyone delivers it.
No compunction telling you that,
right?
Which I love.
Right. He's got a really cool house they made him out in Crewe, right next to the factory. It's where he lives when he's near the factory. It's fantastic.
Our buddy, Tom Gale.
Tom Gale, of course, a regular judge on Motor Trend's Car of the Year panel, and I must say I've learned more about cars from that man than almost any other person. Until you get up close and personal with a car and have Tom show you what you're looking at. You never look at a car again
gesture
the same way.
Gesture and form and how it goes surface down the road. Surface detail.
Well, yeah. Grain and gloss and interiors, Jono. You're now an expert.
Door hem flange. Right. Yep. Oh, Ralph. I had a very intimate experience with Ralph this morning.
Yep, our good buddy, head of design at FCA.
And he's done some terrific cars for them, you know, from a design point of view.
He did the 300. That turned the fortunes of that company around in the eyes of a lot of people. It's a bold, contemporary design that needed to happen when it happened.
Kevin Hunter of Calty, our good buddy also. We worked on a project on FT1 with his team. I think very quiet in the design world, but produces products that really move the industry.
And sells more of them than anybody.
Right.
So this is just half of the honorary judges lineup, and they never have a problem finding people who want to come and be honorary judges. And to make the distinction, the regular judging panel is made up from experts, people who really know the category, the rules, and what's required. Honorary judges come along to add that little bit of opinion, that little expertise, and also that little bit of controversy in terms of the style and that sort of element of the Concours that's really quite subjective.
Absolutely.
And it's a nice honor, you know. It's you've contributed a lot to the car industry. We're going to honor you a little bit.
It's
and by the way,
it's a lot of pressure too. You know, it's funny. Yeah. I've been talking with Kim McCullough from Jaguar. She's judged different Concours. This is the first time here, and she came in and was like, "Oh, you know, I'm kind of nervous, and I got to go to the judges meeting. I don't really know what's going." You know, a lot of the judges actually don't know the class they'll be judging until morning of. They come in here and they get assigned. I was talking to Dave Merrick, and he's of Acura Design. He is super nervous and excited to be here. He's taking it very, very seriously. One of his PR people is like, "I've never seen him so serious." And he's a very jovial person. So
Mr. Leo Levine,
it's great.
Stanford,
oh, Leo Levine.
Legend.
Legendary historian. Used to be a Mercedes PR man at one point.
Racer. He's raced several Mercedes.
He's one of the legends in our profession. We're just talking about Dave Merrick. Yes, and yes, he is. He's generally a jovial character, but he says he's very serious.
Very
today.
Serious. He's dressed in all black. He has his own style. He's got like a ponytail, but it's trimmed off now. It's all. He's taking this incredibly seriously for a man who designs modern cars.
Our very good friend Jochen Maas.
Is he wearing the hat that you?
He's wearing the hat that I took him shopping, and he bought that hat. Told him he looked like Hannibal Lecter.
Jochen Maas, also my buddy from Mille Miglia.
Focus on Pebble Beach Car Week.
Yeah, great guy.
He's a really good guy.
Kim McCullough, of course, from Jaguar Land Rover. This is really, Jaguar is a big part of the Pebble Beach culture. From the early SS cars through to E-types, D-types, C-types.
Right, some of the most beautiful cars in the world.
Sterling Moss.
A real legend. A lot of racing drivers. You know, that the term legend is bandied around a lot. This man is absolutely the real deal. His victory in the 1955 Mille Miglia, in the wheel of the 300 SLR, the most epic drive of all time. Glenn, of course, one of the stalwarts of the Pebble Beach Concours, and has been co-chairman of the event until 2005, and he's been chief honorary judge for the past several years.
Thorsten. Thorsten at the Quail.
This man has three umlauts in his name.
Rolls Royce. Pretty cool job.
He has a great job, and he really enjoys it. He just seems to be smiling all the time. Gordon Murray, one of the most innovative Formula One designers, and of course the McLaren F1.
People who don't know, this is the man, three-seat F1, that's his baby. He's considered a legend in the business. Every designer looks up to him and what he's done.
He's dressed incredibly well, I have to say.
Bright yellow.
That's a suit.
There used to be an event every year, a soapbox derby at Gordon's place, and all the Formula One designers would turn up with their cars. So you can imagine what that was
like. I've heard it's the most frightening experience of a driver's life is one of those soapbox derbies. The McLaren guys told me, the McLaren's chief test driver says, it is frightening to drive those soapbox derby cars.
Dan bought his hat at Ace Hardware. Forgot to get a hat.
The hat's almost bigger than Dan, I think.
Our colleague from the Wall Street Journal, Pulitzer Prize winning car.
He'll probably be on the desk here in hours.
Franz Josef Pefkin, absolute gentleman and a man with an absolutely impeccable eye. He was the one that really guided Bentley back to greatness after the Volkswagen takeover.
Andy Palmer, you're
I went up the hill with Andy, the new Lagonda, and he's just such a cool guy. He's just such a
head of Aston Martin.
And then talk about a dream job for a young British guy.
And good luck to him. I mean, Aston Martin has got some challenges. It's out on its own now. It doesn't have.
But he's saying they have the financing in place. That was the hard part. Now they are going to get the design and the product. We shall see. Right. Wish him luck.
So I think he's definitely relishing the challenge. And he's working with this guy, of course, Marek Reichman, who the Aston Martin Vulcan that Reichman designed is just completely over the top, isn't it? Was that the loudest thing at...
It had to be the loudest car, maybe the loudest car I've ever heard, outside of like a top fuel car. But he also did the CC100, which is that roadster, which had the cutouts in the doors, kind of elegant, unlike the Vulcan, which is,
Dr. Ian Robinson, member of the board for BMW, former head of Rolls-Royce.
Yes.
Met him, very, very sharp guy. Knows luxury, knows everything.
Another great Sir Jackie Stewart. I've been fortunate enough to have ridden with him in drives over the years. I mean, the man is, again, you can see why he won three world championships.
Whip sharp.
Chris Swenson, I first worked with him when I worked with Ford Motor Company back in 1999. He was in Britain. He's the man that pulled together the latest Ford GT, so that's his baby. He's very proud of that car. Designer and Ford Germany's design
student. Beautiful car. Freeman Thomas from Laguna Beach, California. Freeman Thomas, another one of our local buddies. Design director for Ford Motor Company,
Strategic Concepts. Freeman's very interesting. He's the Chrysler 300 came from a concept car that Freeman did that was so over the top they toned it down and it still looked pretty bad.
There's our friend Franz.
Franz von Holzhausen.
This is the man that made the Tesla Model S look so great.
He also designed the Pontiac.
Now they've said Gordon from Sindelfingen, Germany. Gordon actually lives in Newport Beach, California, and he loves surfing.
And likes to go surfing, yeah.
And he also designed the new AMG GT, which I think
Ed Welburn, great buddy of mine.
Yeah.
Head of GM design. We've done a lot. We did Truck of the Year. I saw him at Le Mans. He always pops up everywhere you don't expect him to be.
Collects vintage cocktail shakers.
Yeah. Vickelman grew a beard.
Super cool.
He's probably the best dressed man.
Stefan Winkelmann's wearing a beard. They are definitely in.
Yeah, yes. Very in. I know. I'm still keeping mine even after he shaves his off.
So, Dave Woodhouse oversaw the Lincoln Continental concept that's out on the lawn here at the concept car lawn at Pebble Beach.
Which is a spectacular concept.
Beautifully detailed in a very nice sensibility.
Chrome.
Kazunori Yamauchi is... He created the Gran Turismo franchise. This guy, he's just turned a passion into an absolute empire.
Yeah, if you love racing games, you owe a lot to that man in white pants. Thank you once again to all of our honorary judges.
That's a good group.
It's a good group, and some good friends of ours in there, and great people to talk to. People who, impart, they have such knowledge of the industry, they have... I think the common thread with all of them is that they really love cars. They're here because they really love cars and they love looking at cars and talking about cars and being around car people.
Right.
It's just great. You learn a lot of stuff over these few days people like that.
This event could not be more perfectly timed for a lot of these very, very busy executives. We have a lot of Germans here. They're mostly on vacation. You don't have to twist anybody's arm to come out here. But
I would say, I know, talking to the Mercedes people, the techs, the ones that come and support the car, they fight amongst each other because all they want to do is come here. And you met last night, Michael Kubler, who's kind of this rock star engine builder. He builds the V12s for Pagani. We were saying that one day, his cars will be here, and it's his first time. It's incredible.
Yeah, he was in awe. He'd always wanted to be here.
His first time to the U.S. even, and he was, and people were walking up to him at the Pagani party like he was a rock star. Michael Kubler, oh, I can't believe I'm meeting you. And not a lot of these people own Paganis. They just know him.
Yes.
And
what we're watching up this coming up onto the ramp at the moment is a tribute to Ed Herman. Ed Herman, a great involvement with the Pebble Beach Concours d'Elegance for many, many years. And it's his wife, Star, and his children, daughters, Emma and Ryan, coming as the Pebble Beach Concours d'Elegance recognizes Ed Herman and tributes Ed Herman, who sadly passed not that long ago. So it's a nice thing to do, to recognize someone that's helped make this event so great.
And a great actor. He was in one of my favorite roles. He played William Randolph Hearst, and Eddie Izzard was playing Charlie Chaplin, and it was great. So it's a nice honor.
It is a nice honor. And again, you know, car guys, you know, some of them have day jobs, like,
like working Brian Johnson from ACDC.
Or right. Brian Johnson's one of your great friends. He has a day job.
You can't get him to talk for more than 5 minutes about music. He doesn't want to talk about the stuff he's done, but he'll talk to you for hours about the cars he's driven, the cars he wants to buy, the cars he's about to buy. He's hilarious. And two-thirds of the stuff he says is not printable or repeatable.
Or broadcast.
Or understandable in some cases because of his accent. But fantastically entertaining guy.
Or the most obvious one, of course, is Jay Leno.
Oh, yeah.
Every time I've ever spoken to him, not a word, not a joke, just very serious about cars. Yeah.
Jay wants to know about cars. He wants to talk about cars. He's one of the most passionate car guys I know. I mean, you go to Jay's garage, he's got a kitchen in there the way you can...
Everything works as it's supposed to.
Don't have to leave while you're working on your car.
That's incredible. You know, it was funny, the first time I was there with you, actually, and he spent 17 minutes about talking to a friend of ours he just met about advising her what car her father should buy. And he was very serious. Like, this is, he said, get a Chevy Volt. This is exactly the car your father wants.
Elegance is subjective. It can be influenced by generational shifts.
So now we're looking at the parade of elegance, and this parade will show us all the cars in Class D, which is the DuPont class, one of the more interesting American automakers. Very well-known family name, DuPont, of course. Been America's richest family since the 1800s. Industrialists, I think they are most of Delaware or something like that.
Delaware, chemists, and then one of them, I think the father of the guy who started the car company, invented smokeless gunpowder, which was a big advantage because you couldn't see where you're shooting from.
Exactly.
And the enemy couldn't see. And in fact, one of these cars is one of my favorite hood ornaments I've ever seen. It's actually a naval gun.
Yeah, we took a picture of that one.
And our friend Sean from West Point, he identified it. I think it was an 1875, like 55-millimeter cannon from some class of battleship. Of course, he knew that. But that's the hood ornament. And right. They're fabulous, these cars. They're really special. And they only made, I think it was 576 cars total, something like that. And there's only 30 left, so something like 40% of all the remaining DuPonts are here right now today. Right. And there's one of them rolling behind us.
And I spent incredible. A number of the members of the family, I think there's about 3,500 DuPont cousins, but a bunch of them own the cars. I spoke to a couple of them on Thursday, Chip DuPont and Paul DuPont, Tom DuPont.
Thomas DuPont, yep.
Yeah, and that was just so enthusiastic and actually deeply honored that cars bearing their name would be on the ramp here at Pebble Beach.
Now, I think maybe for some people it's hard to understand the passion that most of everyone here feels about cars, but when you get to talking to guys like this and what this car means to them, especially this where it's family legacy.
Your name's on the car, right?
Yeah, and it's inspiring to hear him talk.
Yeah. So this is a 1928 DuPont Model D Merrimack dual cowl Phaeton. Merrimack was the bodybuilder.
Quite nice. Hopefully the H is going to come across, which is, I think, that's my pick to win this class. But I do love this one with the French headlights. It's beautiful. And the hood ornament.
They're the woodlight headlights. They were these amazing designs. They're meant to have a parabolic reflector that concentrated the beam. Unfortunately, it did. It worked, but it concentrated the beam just 6 feet in front of the car, so they were next to useless. And this is
and they would blind the oncoming cars extremely well. So
it looks really cool when they're when they're on.
Yeah, sure. Great in the day. Great in the daytime.
So this is a 1929 Model G Waterhouse Roadster, and the only known example of the Model G Roadster to survive today. And there's a certain stature to this car. You forget how big these cars were in the late 20s, early 30s. They're massive.
Yeah, you said 500 and some DuPonts. There, 200 and 250 of them were Model Gs. But again, very rare to have a Roadster. I think, and then the Model H. Did we just see a Model H? There's like three of them.
There's three, and I think there's one here, and it's
yes, there's a Model H.
Former best of class winner. Right. You can't miss it. It's cream with a black top, and it's a dual cowl Phaeton, and it's absolutely spectacular. As is this DuPont right here.
Yes.
I sort of only know these cars by the hood ornaments, but they're all wonderful.
This is the one I think it has the hand. Hand pinstriping. I think it's red, red pinstriping.
Right. But look at that hood ornament. Oh my God. That's just incredible.
Just the extravagance of these cars, or the fun people had with these cars when they're personalizing, you know, the bodybuilders, the bodies being done.
Speaking of hood ornaments, Eagles. There's a Packard over there, actually has one on there, but beautiful crystal hood ornament. Love the red wheels on this one.
Yes, this is, I believe, the 29 Model G, four-place speedster.
If you're not familiar with these cars, go rent a movie with Leonardo DiCaprio, Great Gatsby. It will tell you a lot about that era, about the opulence, about the kinds of people that would have the money to buy such vehicles.
So I talked to Tom DuPont about this car that won its class 7 years ago. He was almost tearing up at the thought he could bring this car back to Pebble Beach earlier than the rules normally allowed, because it was part of a featured mark. And it was quite a sports car. It had an exhaust cutout. You know, you think the guys on the lakes in California in the 40s invented it. I think he's just fired it up then, too.
This is the one with the hand pinstriping. That blue color is an original Cadillac color from that era.
So this is another Model G, a Waterhouse convertible coupe, and one of 273 Model Gs produced between 1929 and 1932, when DuPont ended all production. You won't miss that one, a very strong red. And the DuPont were interesting, and they had different grill styles, and a lot of them had painted grills when other ones had a lot of nickel-plated and Lalique radiator ornament, very popular.
Those are spectacular. The value of that is actually more than some of the cars on the lawn, those hood ornaments. I can't remember what they were, but they're incredibly valuable for an original crystal hood ornament.
Another Model G, this one, a 1929 Merrimack Club Coupe. So the first Model G was introduced at the New York Auto Show in January 1929 as a two-passenger speedster with sporting coachwork from Merrimack, and the Merrimack Bodywork Company was in Massachusetts. The Model G was priced from $4,360 to $5,750, which in the depth of the Depression was an awful lot of money.
Probably why they only made 576 DuPonts.
Well, this particular Model G Club Coupe is reported to have been shown at the 1929 Philadelphia Auto Show and then used as a service vehicle for DuPont Motors. And yes, look at this. This is wonderful.
Look at the color.
1930 DuPont Indianapolis race car. Absolutely spectacular. Just look at it. Look at the stance. It's all engine, bobtail, big wheels.
Wheels pushed out to the corners. I mean, that's just grip. And it's cool. It has that amazing look of, you know, the old Millers and all the old Indy cars. It's just stunning. Plus, of course, leather straps holding the bonnet down.
Look at how big the steering wheel is. Look at the seating position. Look at the airbag and the. Oh, wait a second. I mean, you think about these guys were racing something
So DuPont used Continental engines. So this one had a production 8-cylinder with a special cam, larger intake ports, and a 2-barrel Stromberg carburetor. Qualified in 19th, but on lap 22 it had to retire from the race.
19 hours is pretty good.
This is a 1930 Model G Merrimack town car.
Yeah.
And this is what a town car really was. A car one took around the town. A closed car. You could be comfortable.
You talk about elegance. I mean, this again, you're seeing this. You see how elegant this vehicle is and just how luxurious.
And the details. And look at the placement on the tires of the mirrors. You know, I mean, that's just...
I'm 100% sold, as you pointed out, on that license plate.
Right.
If that's the original California blue plate, that's cool. But it's kind of redundant. I guess you got... Oh, here's the one with the naval gun hood ornament.
Yes, the 1930 DuPont Model G Merrimack Speedster, and this has a real character to this car. Look at the fenders, and in red, and the sort of streamlining on the wheels and the underbody of the car.
I do love that it doesn't have wire wheels. I mean, nothing against wire wheels, but every now and then seeing a car of this era with something bold like that. And again, look at the hood ornament.
That's the one with the naval gun on there. Yeah. That to the heritage.
Imagine that coming. Talk about, like, we don't care about pedestrian safety. This is
that's phenomenal.
Yeah, it's really good. Now I think this is the class winner. I think this is one of the most elegant, beautiful cars. Now this admittedly is an H. They only made 3 of these right before the company folded. But to me, this is what you're looking for in a Concorde Elegant car. I mean, look at this thing.
If you're not a fan or don't know much about this era, the one thing at an event like this, a Concorde Elegance, it's that next level. What is it? Again, you mentioned it, the rarity. This one, there's only 3 of them. The finish on it, I mean, all the DuPonts are special, but there are certain ones that I think separate themselves because there's just not as many of them.
But also, I mean, just look at the two-tone, how it flows. It's not just like following hard lines. It's elegant. One of the hinges is white. One of the hinges is black. I think it's just an absolutely spectacular car. Plus, it has a cool, crystal Falcon hood ornament. So that's bonus points there, but if we were betting, I would put my money on this one for this class. And actually, I think it probably has a pretty good shot if it wins at Best of Show too.
We'll talk about this a bit later, a bit more in detail as the show goes on. But there is a certain style to a Pebble Beach Best of Show winner, and this car is probably the first one we've seen today with that. And this.
Speaking of running down peasants.
This is another one. Another one. Duesenberg, of course, a huge part of Pebble Beach for many, many years now, and a real throwback to an era when these massive American cars ruled the roads.
You said something interesting to me one time. I guess you said that Duesenberg were the Veyrons of their day. There was nothing as powerful. There was nothing as fast. There was nothing as luxurious or as expensive.
Well, you know, a Model SJ, which was the supercharged car, it could 116 miles an hour in second gear and 140 miles an hour in top gear. And we're talking early 1930s. I mean, that's as stratospheric a performance difference as, most modern, reasonable modern cars will do 130, 150 miles an hour now to a Veyron.
Right.
And it was just as expensive.
Yeah. And, it's also interesting, there was a time when the biggest, baddest cars in the world were American. And, it was before the war. But Packards, Duesenbergs, Cadillacs, Marmons, Lincolns. I mean, these were, if you had an incredible amount of wealth, you didn't really look at Rolls Royce actually back then. You looked at a Packard, or 16-cylinder Marmon or a Cadillac. So just an interesting time in history.
And this is an interesting moment for car enthusiasts too. I mean, we're seeing 3 Walker Legrand Duesenbergs up on the stand there. These this particular body style, which was done on the Model J and on the Model SJ, is one of the most elegant of all the big coupes. They're just perfectly proportioned. Look how low that windshield is. That's how it was built. No one's customized these things.
First time these all three, I think, appear together.
So. Yes, and this is for the Lauren Tryon Award. The Lauren Tryon Trophy recognizes an automotive enthusiast who has contributed significantly to the Pebble Beach Concours d'Elegance. Tryon served as the Concours co-chairman for nearly 30 years, and his passion and expertise drew the most elegant cars to Pebble Beach year after year. And this year's winner, General William Lyon, has been collecting cars for over 5 decades. He first showed a car here in 1965. It was a 1925 Rolls-Royce Phantom One. General Lyon is a much decorated member of the military, a very successful businessman, and an active supporter of community arts and charitable organizations. He also has, in common with many car people, a passion for planes and established the Lyon Air Museum to preserve the memory of aviators in wartime. So, General Lyon helped bring these three cars together for the Concours this year. And here he is about to receive his award.
Lauren was a leader, mentor, and friend of our event, and above all, dedicated his entire life to the collector car.
So Sandra Button presenting General Lyon with the award. He's shown everything here over the years, from an early 1908 Bugatti to a 1965 Alfa Romeo TZ2, but is best known for his outstanding collection of classic era cars, and particularly Duesenbergs.
As we can see,
it's hard to even differentiate between these two. They're all
1925 Rolls-Royce Phantom One. General William Lyon is a much decorated member.
So, cars like this, there's a couple of contenders to watch in class. The Duesenberg class is one of the classes that has a car in it that may, one of these Walker LeGrand convertibles is tipped at as being one of the cars. It's one of only the three built. We've seen all three together, and but this particular car, the 1934 Model J, owned by Harry Heggie from Cincinnati, Ohio, is fresh out of restoration. So that's one the judges are saying could be a contender. We'll see how it goes. Of course, best in show, you have to win your class here to be considered best in show.
Comes the
so we're about to start getting the awards now, so we're getting down to the interesting
these are the coolest. I mean, these are the brass era cars, and you know, no one's really got posters of these hanging up, and kids aren't going gaga for them, but they're kind of they're amazing. I mean, they're over 100 years old, a lot of these things. And they move around, and they're just—it's just cool, and it just seemed—it's—it's like looking, you know, at the ancestor of the modern car, because these really were motorized buggies.
Well, the antique class is 1914 and earlier, and you know, the early days of the automotive industry were a lot like the dot-com boom. There were 485 auto companies started in America between 1900 and 1908.
Before consolidation. Right?
253 was still in business when the year Henry Ford introduced the Model T and General Motors was formed. And so what happens now, what we'll see through, for those of you who haven't been here, is that the first, second, and third place finishers are brought up to the base of the ramp, but none of the three knows who's won until the judges point and tell them. So first car to come up will be the third place car, second place, and then so on.
When did you go up, take a look at the horn on the Rolls Royce. Don't know what order it is, but the horn alone could win its class just for this thing. It has six trumpets.
So the little red car is a 1903 Thomas. That's one of the oldest cars here. I think only the 1902 Panhard is older. And Johnny, you've driven one of these antique cars. How tricky are they?
Almost impossible. It was a Model T, but I mean, the pedals aren't in the right place, right? The gas pedal's in the middle, and then you're worried about spark advance, and you're worried about some of them have total loss oiling, where you know the oil by design escapes the vehicle. Here we go. Here's our third place car.
Yes.
This Here it's moving up the ramp. You can hear it. There's a great horn.
It's the Thomas. It's the third place in the antique class. The Thomas Company began producing automobiles in 1903 after selling motorized bicycles for some years. The company became famous for the Thomas Flyer, one of America's most successful automobiles, after winning the 1908 New York to Paris road race. You remember that movie as a kid, The Great Race? Because I always thought that the Thomas was the coolest looking car. I never knew it was the Thomas back then, of course.
I mean, it's on bicycle tires. And again, like most, you know, antique car companies, they started out with bicycles.
That's one of, that Thomas is one of three, only three known to exist. Okay, so second place, it looks like it's going to the 1910 Speedwell. Now, here's the thing. The car has to be able to start and move up onto the ramp under its own power, and they get a couple of attempts at it, and if it doesn't do it on its second attempt, sorry, you lose. So right. Imagine what that feels like.
To come that far and not win.
And this is, again, obscure is the wrong word, but forgotten by time company. I mean, you know, Speedwell. Made about 4,000 cars, and very few left. I believe there's something like a dozen, maybe, are known to still exist.
They built cars in Dayton, Ohio, between 1907 and 1914. So, and in 1911, they built a closed two-door car that they named a sedan. It's the first recorded use of the name.
Right, even though it had two doors. And here's your class winner, a 1914 Rolls-Royce Silver Ghost at Kellner Torpedo Phaeton. We usually pronounce Phaeton, but I believe it's actually Phaeton. And it's gorgeous.
Lovely, lovely car. This is just a certain absolute elegance and gravitas to the old Rolls-Royce.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
And for a 101-year-old car, it really doesn't look that old. I mean, it's old, but it's gorgeous, beautiful.
This has got its original torpedo Phaeton bodywork that was originally built by Kellner of Paris. The car was ordered through Rolls-Royce of France for a Portuguese customer, and it spent most of its life in Portugal. And it was restored in, brought back to England and restored in 2009-2012.
Beautiful, beautiful. We can see the horn. I think it's going to make the left turn now.
We've missed it. We've
beautiful
missed
horn. Here's a very interesting class of cars coming up. This is Pope. It's American manufacturer, and again, this is the interesting thing. It was a whole bunch of bicycle manufacturers that were consolidated, and then they began building automobiles. And what's neat about these is where the various popes were built, that became the name of the car. So you would have the Pope Hartford was the most amount of popes, but also you have Pope Toledo, the one with the W, I'm blanking at the moment. None of them are here. But anyways, I think there were six Pope factories in all.
Oh, they had Pope Waverley and Pope Robinson.
Waverley. Yes, thank you. Pope Waverley was the one I was trying to think of.
So this is our third place, and this is the 1904 Pope Toledo Type 4 rear entrance tonneau.
What's interesting cool, you can see on the grill, it says Pope and then the Hartford behind it, or in this case, Toledo.
The interesting about this class is that every single one is in California, but one. They're all
rust-free.
I guess so.
You don't want to have a California car. These are neat cars. It was fun to see these running on the Tour d'Elegance. It's amazing they still run like that.
So this is the 1909 Pope Hartford Model S. And this car, bigger car. You can see how quickly the cars were developing in the early eras. This one, by 1909, Pope Hartford had become a well-regarded luxury car with a reputation built on endurance racing. And this Model S has a four-cylinder overhead valve, 40 horsepower engine. It cost $2,750 in 1909 when a Model T was selling for $800, which might explain why there are no more Popes around.
Right.
Neat car. This is a neat name too. It's a Toytana.
And the winner in the class.
Here we go. Is a 1912 Port Hartford 27 Pony Tonneau owned by Kirk and Ross Bewley of Sacramento, California. You can kind of see a bit of a pattern here. The last two class winners have kind of actually look quite similar. Long, low, and quite elegant.
And I think one of the reasons why this one is this class one is it is so rare. I mean, there's only one of two in existence. So if you need to get down to separating brass tacks, like what makes this one so special? Well, there's two of them.
Bit of a tiebreaker. But obscurity alone isn't enough to win. I mean, you also have to look like that.
Right.
And have that restoration. And gorgeous car. Gorgeous car.
Oh, we've had a flat tire.
That's awesome. Oh, we got a little chitty chitty bang bang, a wobble.
Yes, so the right rear tire's gone flat. This was a pretty common occurrence back in the day. Of course, we forget about it now.
That's why there are two spares right there.
Driving these cars and you had the detachable rims, you became quite proficient. You'll notice the spare tires are already inflated and they're on rims. You didn't peel the tire off the rim. You just unbolted the rim from the spokes and put a new one on.
Yeah, that ride can't be very good with. I mean, that's basically the suspension in the car is the tire.
Up next, we have the vintage class.
The vintage class, and
here's our third place car. Duesenberg.
Yeah.
1923 Duesenberg, a Millepaw and Irish five-passenger touring. We were talking about Duesenberg a second ago, but again, in a lot of ways, when people think of the Concours d'Elegance, your mind might snap immediately to a Duesenberg because of the stateliness, the gracefulness, and the design. It's interesting, though, the earlier kind of pre-26, 27 Duesenbergs, they didn't have the imposing world-beating caliber of the later cars. Still, this is a pretty car.
It's quite petite for Duesenberg. It doesn't have that sort of thrusting massive engine and a little body tacked on the rear.
Clark Gable wouldn't necessarily be seen in this.
No, you wouldn't see Clark Gable or Gary Cooper, two very famous Duesenberg owners.
Here comes a Mercer. 1923 Mercer Series 6 Sporting is our second place winner in Class B, the vintage class. Mercer's long history. There was the Mercer Runabout. This is obviously kind of a more luxurious passenger vehicle. And
it's interesting. Mercer started in 1909, and I believe it's named after Mercer County in New Jersey. And the Raceabout was one of the world's first sort of performance cars. It held tons of records. It was a very popular, fast sporting car. This particular one, yes, is a much more...
reserved, but again, quite elegant sort of family sedan.
You know what's fascinating about this class is that, you know, we saw in the antique class, we saw a Rolls-Royce. There are no brands in this class that survived through to the modern era.
Right.
So, you know, we had our third place car, the Duesenberg. We've just had our second place car here, the Mercer. And what have we got coming up next for the winner?
I do wish the winner still was in existence, because I do love the name of the brand and the model.
Yeah, so legendary car, 1920 Stutz Series H Bearcat. So the Stutz Bearcat, I mean, that's one of the best names in the history of cardom. It's up there with Buick Roadmaster.
Period, end of story. Yeah.
Right, this is a Bearcat. What are you driving?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, you know, you'd like to think that, you know, the muscle car guys in Detroit in the 60s had all the cool names, but yeah, I agree with you. Stutz Bearcat.
Yeah. They were just cool cars. And this one is just, first of all, yellow, hard to go wrong with yellow and black. It's just a stunner.
Leno's got a Stutz Bearcat.
I'm sure. We can ask him if he shows up. At least one.
See, the Bearcat, soon after the first car was built in 1911, Harry C. Stutz set the prototype to the inaugural Indy 500, where the untested car did pretty well.
Listen to that,
it's a good-sounding, strong-sounding car.
Yeah, that sounds terrific.
Oh boy, here we go. Okay, this is Class C1 American Classic Open, and our third place car, 1936 Cadillac 90 Fleetwood convertible sedan. And that's a Cadillac. I mean, standard of the world. Look at this thing. Just humongous and long and lean and low. Curvy, gorgeous car. Lots of chrome, lots of bling.
Is this the golden age of elegance for American cars? You think the
beginning, I would say.
I think it was a longer age, because Cadillac did survive the war, kind of unlike Packard in a lot of ways, because you can't discount the 40s and 50s Cadillacs, and even the early 60s Cadillacs either.
Or the Lincolns, too.
Well, Lincoln's, of course. Yeah, absolutely. And that Hurderman, gold woman flying at you.
Ah, this Graham, the 1937 Graham, model 97 Souchak, the eccentric French bodywork designer.
Eccentric's a great way to put it, Angus, because look at this thing.
It's an Art Deco masterpiece, this car, and it's come second, which means this one was talked about as being a possible contender for Best of Show.
And it's no longer a contender because it did not win first.
If you're new to this era, one of the things to look at is how nautical the lines are. I mean, vehicles of this era, luxury vehicles in particular, it's about having a double bow wake. It's about having the curve over the front fender and of the rear fender. It looks like the luxury cruise liners of the day. You can see it in the trim. You can see it in the chrome work. I mean, this is, not to be offensive, it's a boat. I mean, this is like a land boat.
And it's also interesting, you know, obviously rockets weren't invented yet, but they were still looking up like comets. So there's a lot of that deco bright work is like right. Comet tails. Right. It's very in vogue.
Yeah.
And here's your winner, 1931 Chrysler CG Imperial LeBaron Dual Cowl Phaeton. And yes.
I mean, whoa. This looks the business, doesn't it? It looks...
This looks like a class winner. And again, this is a Chrysler, which is incredible.
I think what's interesting is that names like Fleetwood and Baron, LeBaron, coach builder names became model names later on. I mean, the uniqueness of the coach builder bodies, you know, Lincoln offered 26 body styles for the V12 KB from 17 different coach builders. Cadillac, 90 customers could choose from over 70 different body styles. Because, you know, back in those days, you bought the chassis and then decided what you were going to put on top of it.
Right.
Which is sadly, you know, nowadays, in the days of, safety, it's just almost impossible to do
mass production. I mean, it would be ridiculously expensive to even try to attempt something that where you're building a totally custom bespoke body.
We're on to class. This is C2 American Classic Open Packard. So Packard is their own class. With third place car. It's a 1934 Packard, 1108-12, Dietrich convertible sedan. And these are as elegant as that Cadillac and that Chrysler. Look at this. I mean, they're so massive. And, you know, you always talk about dash to axle. I mean, the axle's in front of the car in this case.
Yeah, Packard is another one of the special brands, brands with a special relationship with the Pebble Beach Concours. It's... They merit their special class. And it's easy to forget, you know, that Packard was, at one stage, America's preeminent luxury brand. In the late 1920s, when a Ford sedan cost $600, a Packard chassis cost $3,000. Then you had to pay to put the body on it.
But you look at these cars, and it becomes extremely obvious that Packard was once the most luxurious car.
So here's
possible.
The second place winner, 1933 Packard 100S12. Convertible Victoria.
Looks like a 1005.
Oh, 1005, sorry.
Yeah. And again, another stunner.
Yeah, Packard initially doubled down on luxury cars when the Depression hit, but it did introduce some lower price models, but kept building, you know, these big,
stately 12 cylinder, wonderful cars. And first in class. Here's your winner, the 1934 Packard 1107-12 convertible Victoria.
Yeah.
So with a V12 engine, which of course gave you smoothness and silence, 160 horsepower, which doesn't sound a lot by today's standards.
But it was a lot back then, and this car has one of those beautiful crystal falcon head hood ornaments, which
from Lalique.
Just yeah, absolutely.
Packard, it was famous for straight eights, but built 5,812 cylinder cars from 1932 to 1939.
But there was pressure too, but they never built a V16. So you had Marmon, I believe, in Cadillac, and I'm blanking on the other one, but there was never a Packard 16.
Arguably the most famous V12 that Packard ever built, of course, was the Merlin engine under license from Rolls-Royce, which they put in P-51 Spitfires in World War II, a plane that the pilots ironically called the Cadillac of the skies.
Okay, we have Class C3 American Classic Close. Here's our third place car. This is a 1934 Packard 1108-12 Dietrich stationary coupe. And, you know, Dietrich, very legendary coach builder and pretty well pedigreed. In fact, 2 years ago, I think the Lincoln Dietrich won Best of Show here at Pebble. And this is a lovely kind of seafoam green.
I just love that it's not black.
Yeah, any color, but not black. Yeah, right. It's great.
It's very, very upright cabin on it.
Kind of a sinister looking car.
Very sinister.
I love that license plate too. Kind of neon green on black.
Yeah, Packard started after World War II in pretty good shape, but of course, sadly, didn't survive. Merged with Studebaker, and we know what happened then.
Here's our second place winner, 1932 Packard 904 Deluxe 8, also a Dietrich stationary coupe.
Similar, very similar to the last one. Just these are just gorgeous cars. And again, elegant. To get back to the whole namesake of this event, I mean that. Again, I know when I see it, there it is. That is an elegant machine.
And it's one of two 1932 stationary coupes by Dietrich known to survive, and has been owned by its current owner for 40 years. I mean, if you had the opportunity to own a car like that, you wouldn't sell it.
Yeah, it's an heirloom. And look at the bright work on these things, that fancy grille, wonderful hood ornament, even where they do the lights. Okay, here is our first place class winner. This is a 1930 Stutz MB Wyman Monte Carlo. Look at that greenhouse. Look how chopped this car is. It's a gangster. It's great.
Looks like it's been into the chop shop, but that's where it came from. From the factory like that. The interesting thing about this car is it has a cloth body or leather body.
Which I love. I mean, that's so, I just think that's the coolest thing.
You think matte finished cars is
new.
A new thing.
Nah,
here it is.
It's
this
all
is
done.
This is a matte finished car. I parked next to this car. I drove a Mercedes Maybach up in a matte silver. And I parked next to that thing, and it was fascinating to see. Fascinating to see what had happened over the 80 years in between.
Oh, here comes the DuPont class, and so we have our third place car. This is the 1929 DuPont Model G Waterhouse Roadster. We talked about this car earlier. Love the color scheme.
Yep.
Love the hood ornament. Really, really like these cars. You know, we talked earlier last year, Ruxton was a special class, and no one had ever heard of Ruxton. You were saying Pebble going to do for DuPont what it did for Ruxton, because all of a sudden there's this big Ruxton craze.
Well, it's interesting. Ruxton was far more under the radar than DuPont was among real serious car collectors. So I don't think it's going to be the same phenomenon.
Okay, here's our second place car, 1929 DuPont Model G Merrimack Special Sedan, and we're joined by a very special guest, Mr. Ian Callum.
Hello, Ian. Can you hear us?
Hi.
Everything good?
Yeah, good. Yeah, fine.
Just your mic here.
Thank you. Okay, it's good. Yep.
How was judging? How was judging? Good.
It was pretty intense. You know, we get into one or two discussions, and funnily enough, this time most of us picked in a car that we really liked, so. It came fairly conclusively, but I only do a little piece. There's a big, big part to this.
For those of you watching at home, Ian is the head of design for Jaguar and Land Rover.
Here's our first place car of the DuPont class. This is the Model H, the 1931 DuPont Model H Merrimack Sport Phaeton. And
I think that means this car's in contention, definitely, as one to watch for a Best of Show winner.
You picked this as a class winner?
I did pick this as a class winner.
All right.
You want to listen to me, I know what I'm talking about. Yeah.
That was on my list.
It's good. You were in a pretty interesting group of judges. I saw you walking around with Andy Palmer.
Yeah.
And you had Wolfgang Dürheimer. Who else was with you?
and
Dave Merrick, I think.
Dave Merrick, right. And Chris Svensson from Ford.
Right.
You know, all you guys were an intimidating group of dudes, kind of.
Well, they know their stuff, and they have an opinion. We all have an opinion.
As do you, my friend.
Of course, yeah.
So what sort of vibe, what buzz do you get from this weekend? Why, you know, you design modern cars. Why do you come here and look at old cars?
I love old cars. That's the thing. And the thing I get from some of these cars, I really don't understand a lot of them because, you know, they're not, I don't have a reference to them. A car like this, I don't see very often. But I get a sense of detail and a sense of proportion. And the thing that really strikes me about them is the finesse, the delicacy that these cars have that, frankly, modern cars don't.
Real quick, we're moving on to the Duesenberg class. This is Class G. We have our third place car in 1931 Duesenberg J, Dernham Tourster.
Now, do you take back stuff back with you to the design studio from here? Do you internalize it, or do you bring some of the younger associates? Is this a good design exercise?
Yeah, I do. Yeah, absolutely. You know, I'm always looking at detail and sense of the presence of these cars, and you're always learning things. And things come and go, and when I go back, I go back with a certain feeling of, you know, something special. But it's very difficult to actually articulate that. You know, it's an atmosphere you're looking for. And the thing that's really great here, which is important to Jaguar, is glamour. You know, Jaguars are very glamorous cars. Modern cars tend not to be that glamorous. But these are all glamorous.
Oh, yeah.
We have our second place car in the Duesenberg class. It's a 1934 Duesenberg J, Walker LeGrand convertible coupe.
And talk about glamorous. I mean, Jeez. Just look at the line on this thing.
Beautiful.
Ian, we've had this conversation before, but you look at parts of this car, especially like the Hordern Ring, which just seems to be like almost a knife. And, you know, you have to worry now about pedestrian safety and crash
safety.
Yeah,
I don't think that would pass.
Aerodynamics and all these horrible, boring things. You know, for aerodynamics, by the way, for fuel economy, not for speed and style. And is there anything we're looking at? Can you translate it to a modern car?
Yeah, you see, I look at a car like that. I see something very strong at the front and very elegantly, but very personally, just flows off through to the back of the car. With a very distinct and confident feeling. I mean, it's so confident.
We have our first place winner.
It's the 1934 Duesenberg J. Walker LeGrand convertible coupe out of Cincinnati, Ohio.
And I think the judges made a pretty good choice here. That's, wow, that's a stunner.
It's another car that's going to
I think we
possibly
need more
be in contention for best of show.
More louvers. I think we need more.
More louvers, yeah. You can't have too many louvers.
You really can't go wrong with louvers. We got to bring them back to modern cars.
Well, you never know.
Says the man who put the
louvers in the Mark II.
And the louvers in the
Mark II. Louvers. There's something very honest about them.
Yes.
Well, you have them on your hot rod, do you?
I do, yes, right down the side. Yeah, many of them.
So what else have you been up to here, Ian? I mean, you here on Sunday, did you go out to the Quail?
Yeah, I went to Quail, and what I love about the Quail is it's such an eclectic mix of cars, you know. There's no sense of everything has to be a specific style. They're all together in one place. I really love that.
Here we have Class H1. This is Rolls-Royce pre-war, very elegant class. And our third place car is a 1933 Rolls-Royce Phantom II Brewster Newport.
How many years have you been coming to Pebble?
Here? 18 now. 18 years, yeah, as a judge. Yeah.
As a judge? As 18 as a judge?
As a judge, yeah. I missed 1 year in the 18, so I've done 17 judges.
Oh, look, this poor thing's having trouble getting up the ramp.
Uh-oh.
Yes. Has to get up onto the ramp.
Got to get up the ramp.
It has to get up the ramp. Otherwise...
So is it still fun, 18 years of judging? Do you look forward to this?
Yeah.
Is this work?
It's different. You know, I think for me, the sense of... anticipation and buzz maybe slightly gone a little bit because I kind of anticipate what's going to happen.
Right.
But every time you come and see new cars, it's all about the cars at the end of the day, and I really enjoy that. And the thing about these cars is that, you know, you never see the same one twice. But the one thing I really enjoy about seeing them is the sense of color. That's something I always love with these, because people used to paint cars the way they wanted them, not the residual value. You know, yes. They weren't grey, white, black. They were painted yellows, blues, greens. And the interiors were equally vibrant. I love that.
Is that something you struggle with modern cars? Because people like white cars, people like gray cars.
Color department, yeah.
You have to design actually to the volume, right? Would you say, like, you know, X percentage is going to be black, white, and silver, and certain shapes look better in those colors than others?
Yeah, I don't pay much attention to how the shape is going to look with the color, because there will be a standard color people buy. White is most popular. Then you got to have two or three grays. And the marketing guys have a say, the dealers have a say, and eventually, hopefully, the designers have a say. But the designers' colors tend to be the ones that don't sell so well.
Right.
And after a couple of years, they'll go.
Right.
Well, they're actually pushing the Royce here up the ramp. Should probably go help. This is a heavy car. There it goes. Look at that.
So this car, I think,
with the wicker on the rear.
Yes, I think this car was actually shown. The Phantom 2 debuted at the 1929 London Olympia Motor Show. That back in the days when London had a motor show.
Good old days.
What I love about these cars, I was looking at all the old Rolls, they all, in the center of the steering wheel, if you've ever sat behind one, they have every control for the carburetor.
The spark advance,
ignition. As they proceeded through time, you have adjustments for ride. It's two levers. It's soft, it's hard. Even the horn, it's the soft horn or the loud horn, and it's all centrally placed in the steering wheel. It's phenomenal.
All right, it looks like this one's going to run, but we have our second place car, 1932 Rolls-Royce Phantom II Continental, Fagoni and Fallaci, pillarless Berlin, which I'm mispronouncing. But
that's very nice.
Thank you for your day job.
But look at this thing. I mean, look at that rear end, rear overhang. Ian, what do you make of that?
It kind of goes against the grain, but I have to love it. You know, it's so extreme, and I love the extremity of it. Yeah. And the way everything just deliberately flows off the back. It's slightly misproportioned because of the big front and the slip back, but it works.
It's interesting, too, because, you know, Fagoni and Fallaci, they're known as these petite, you know, the teardrop coupes, these small little French things, and then they get this mega Rolls-Royce, and they're kind of doing the same stuff, but it's just a huge scale.
It's out of proportion, especially when you see that grill, the Rolls-Royce grill, which we all know and understand. It's slightly strange to see this coming off the back of it.
Right.
But it works, you know. Works.
And here's our winner, 1933 Rolls-Royce Phantom II Brewster Special, permanent new market.
So this is a Brewster bodywork, which means it was done here in the United States, this bodywork. And, of course, that's the other part of this era of cars. You've got such variety in what you actually put on the chassis. It you really could let your imagination run riot.
Well, that sounds like fun, because they must need a lot of designers in those days. I love the idea that you've got the running chassis and you can style your suit for the top of it. You know, the world's not quite like that.
It's a great lead. We were talking about it before you got here. Do you think there'll ever be a time with the ability to build anything on one line where you could really get back into coach building modern cars?
I think there's a place for it. I don't think it's in mass production. Mass production is becoming much more about efficiency and the volume. The very sense of complexity is very, very difficult.
Here we have the next class, the H2 Rolls-Royce and Bentley post-war. Our third place winner is already on the ramp. 1958 Rolls-Royce Silver Cloud James Young Coupe.
Two-door, yeah, beautiful.
Quite a looker.
I get this. I remember them.
It's a lot of car to have two doors on, especially with that really large rear window. They haven't bought the. It's definitely a four-passenger two-door.
We talked about it briefly. There's a lot of cars here. The whole era basically represented of modern vehicles. But truly, even for a car guy such as yourself, your interest begins at one period.
It does, yeah.
What era would you say?
I think my lifetime, probably mid-50s onwards.
Speaking of mid-50s, we're about to roll the second place car, which this was kind of my sentimental favorite to win. Yes. 1953 Bentley R-Type Continental H.J. Mulliner.
Look at that.
Sports Saloon. This was the Ian Fleming James Bond car.
This was, yeah.
And then look at this thing.
And there's no debate over that car. It's been recognized as being so beautiful, perfect for so many years. So what can you say?
It's flamboyant yet restrained. There's something really British about that.
So British.
That?
let's be a little bit, you know, kind of daring, but don't overdo it.
That's a masterpiece. I love this.
It is a masterpiece.
The proportion is just how long, how elegant the line is.
That line.
But you know, the bravery of taking that roof and sinking in between defenders. That's pretty cool stuff.
All right, here's our winner. Look at this thing. This beat the Bentley. This is the 1952 Rolls-Royce Phantom for Hooper Sedanica DeVille. Ian, we're talking about color. Let's have you take this one away.
Yeah, the color's good, but you know, I never understood Hoopers. I have to say to you.
I'm with you. I agree.
They always look a little bit overbodied, and it's very green.
I took a close look at this thing. The beautiful, the fun little factoid here is there's a dictaphone in the back, Weber Chicago Giant recording and a microphone. So the executive who was being chauffeured.
Very important man. Very can say his man. Very important thoughts.
He can record his thoughts while
posterity.
While being cosseted in style. It's hilarious.
Yeah, it's a little cartoonish.
What's interesting
is it's very tall, narrow. You can imagine that going down Pall Mall, can't you? Yeah. You know, with something special in the back. But
it is lovely, though. I mean, look at that.
It's lovely.
With a small L. I like it. I'm just sorry.
Yeah, I don't think Ian and I are fans of that one. I'm not a Hooper.
I never got a Hooper.
Okay, here comes our next class. This will be interesting. This is Class I, and this is Mercedes-Benz. And here comes. I don't want to jump the gun here. Okay, I assume it's our third place car. There's two cars out there, but this is a 1935 Mercedes-Benz 500K single fingin roadster.
I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen. Moving to the wrong page.
Uh-oh.
Now we're going to have I, which is Mercedes.
Okay, we were okay.
Having a little bit of confusion on the ramp. We were right.
Go us.
500K Sindelfingen Roadster. Sindelfingen is the...
It's got my vote, this car, in one sense or another. I like the sense of sportiness in it. You felt like you could walk up to it, get in it, and drive it.
Right.
It has no doors, if I'm correct.
This car is also the
winner. And I love the tight fenders around the wheels. Very purposeful.
And it sits very low. Interesting though, with these era Mercedes, the heft in all the surfaces and all the forms of the car, very very different.
Yeah, and it's very Teutonic in a way. You know, everything has to look strong. It's not to be strong, but look strong. And but there's a charm about that. It's reassuring.
Sindelfingen is the home of Mercedes-Benz, so it's just named after the birthplace of the brand.
Okay, here we have the second place car is running. 1936 Mercedes-Benz 500K Tourer. The K's obviously are special cars. This one, to me, looks a little bit more like a Mercedes, proper Teutonic, as you were saying, Ian, than the last one, the third place car. But again, I mean, that muscular, you know, I want to be a train.
Yeah, I said that actually. I was looking at this. It looks like a train. Looks like it's coming at you, and yeah.
It's funny that K in the modern naming convention means Klein, means small. And these are anything but small cars, except in the era they, you know, I guess.
And here comes the winner. And look at this thing, 1928 Mercedes-Benz 680S Tourer.
That's a
tourer. What we call a thumper.
Yeah.
This car is a definite contender for best of show, but talk about a hot rod, this thing. It's 6.8 litre, and it had a kick-down supercharger, so you could kick the button in, and the supercharger would kick in with this enormous scream, which is, if you've ever seen the Mad Max movie, that's kind of what Mel Gibson does. But
and you know when Mercedes, when they start using numbers 6 and 7, the cars get very potent, very powerful, very impressive.
Stunning. The supercharger could only be used for about a minute, or you'd blow the engine up. It's sort of like the 1920s equivalent of nitrous. Really.
Or it's like brand new, like, you know, how the Porsche 911 has overboost for 15 seconds.
Right.
Well, Ian and Callum, thanks for joining us on the desk. Yeah. We better let you get back to some champagne.
We didn't rake you over the coals here, bro. This is a
the champagne waste.
You don't want to sit around for the French classes?
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Callum, thanks very much.
Thank you.
And here's the next class J1 European Classic earlier. Third place cars on the ramp. 1929 Bentley, 4.5 liter Vandenplaat 4-seater. And yeah, this is one of those leather-bodied Bentleys, and kind of a personal favorite of mine. A leather on the outside, I think, is always kind of a very cool thing to do, and this is a very cool car.
Yeah, a leather-body car is something you need to see and hopefully be able to touch for yourself, because just looking at a picture, you don't understand why it's kind of a dull finish.
Right.
You go up and you see them, and it's insane. You're like, they put leather on the outside.
Oh, the Austro-Daimler.
Oh, this is kind of a little bit of, not an upset, but the 1932 Austro-Daimler ADR8. I'm going to butcher this part, excuse me. The Kübel Carrosserie Work.
Which means bodybuilder in German. Now, this car is owned by Jack Nethercutt, and the Nethercutt family are the most successful car owners here at Pebble Beach. Between them, they've won six massive shows.
And we thought if it won, this could be maybe a dark horse could compete, but it didn't, because the next car, which, by the way, at 11 a.m. when it's on live on the internet, you can see this car I picked to win Best of Show, is now the class winner, eligible for Best of Show, 1924, Isada Fraschini Tipo 8A F. Ramsier, and the Warblarfen Convertible Cabriolet.
Yeah, Warblarfen. I'll help you out with the German. It was a Swiss-bodied Isotta Fraschini, Italian company Isotta Fraschini. This car rebodied in 1932 and shown at the 1933 Geneva show, I think. This car is a definite contender for Best of Show. So mark the cards now.
I call this one. I'm officially. This is.
Listen, you're not the only one, Johnny. I talked to five different people who think that's the front runner.
Hey man, that's okay. You want to pick the winner, right? Ed?
Exactly.
You want to pick the one that wins. But again, elegance. Dash to axles has everything you can look for.
It has a certain classic Pebble Beach proportion to it. And this car, the Isotta Fraschini, has only had four owners since new and spent most of its time living a quiet life in Switzerland and France before coming to America last year.
That's amazing.
We've got our next class, J2, European Classic late. It's fair to say Best of Show winner could come out of either of the J classes. Here's our third place car, the 1939 Bentley, 4.5 liter. Park Ward Sports Coupe, and sort of a small car for a Bentley.
It is. It's a Bentley, the 4.25. It was this car was known as the Honeymoon Express. It was built for the chairman of the coach builder Park Ward and showed at the Earls Court Motor Show in London in 1938. It's one of the very few two-passenger cars built on the 4.25 Derby chassis. And because it was built for the chairman of Park Ward, it has quite a few bespoke features, including the sunshine roof, the frameless triplex side windows, deluxe wheel discs, and uniquely designed rear-wheel spat.
Yeah. A little bit of an upset. This is the 1939 Bugatti Type 57C Van Vooren Cabriolet.
Yes.
A lot of people sort of had this one picked.
This one, yeah, if you're a populist like me, you would pick this one because it's a Bugatti, because it's a Type 57. These are those vehicles that win everything, it seems. And it's the only one here, and it's a cabriolet, so you think this would be the winner.
This car, which is owned by the Margie and Robert E. Peterson Collection, I've seen this car in the basement of our old office building. This was once owned by the Shah of Iran. In fact, was given to the Shah by the French government. It certainly beats being given a nice gold watch or a pencil, doesn't it?
Yes, just slightly. I think maybe this one didn't win because this design, not the front end but the side, it was common. There's two Delahaye's, Peter Mullinones, that looked very similar. So while it's a rare car, we've seen this design. And, you know, he had both those at Goodwood, Mullen did.
But it's interesting, this is not a Fagonia Falaschi body. This is actually by Van Buren in Paris. And clearly they were channeling their rivals.
Here, I believe, is the rightful winner of this class, and this is one that a lot of people have said are also picked to win Best of Show. 1937, Delahaye, 145, Frenet, Cabriolet, and I mean, that might be the most deco car in history. Yeah. Look at this thing.
This car is really a hot contender for Best of Show. So I think we're down to this and the Isotta will be there. Now, interestingly, this car started life as a 12-cylinder Grand Prix car.
It'd be like putting a
body on Lewis Hamilton's Mercedes. But that's what happened. There was nothing less valuable than last year's race car. So 12-cylinder engine. Actually, the chassis is said to be the car that René Dreyfus beat the Silver Arrows in a race in 1939.
Which is incredible that a car could beat, that beat a Silver Arrow could ever look like this.
Rebodied after, the chassis was hidden away during World War II and was rebodied after the war, but the guy who commissioned it never turned up to purchase it. So a lovely looking car, really dramatic looking car, but not large. It's
actually weird in that it is. There are cars here that are a lot longer and have a more of a line to them. But that one, just the presence, the styling, the Art Deco effect.
And here we have a cool class. This is the K1 British pre-war sports cars early, and our third place car. We're going to announce in a second, but we did see this thing with us on the Tour de Elegance. And Angus, I remember you pointed out to me and said, "Johnny, look at that." And they just announced it, so it's Wait one second.
We're waiting to see. Of course, this is part of the tension here, is people not knowing until the judge points at them.
Here it is. All right. 1932, Invicta S Car Bodies Tour. And Invicta was a very cool company. It was a British company, and you had American power with British kind of everything else, and the cars are stunning. Underslung chassis, so they're sitting on the ground. Just wonderful cars, and third place.
And Invicta was an interesting company. It sort of came and went. This particular car was, or the S-Type version of this car, won the 1931 Monte Carlo Rally with Donald Healey driving. And if you think the Healey name sounds familiar, you're right. It's the Healey as in Austin Healey. He loved rally driving back in the day. This car was considered a bit of an outsider in for Best of Show, and clearly it's not going to be a contender this year because it hasn't won its class.
Here comes our second place car for the K1 class. It's a 1926 Bentley 3-liter speed model Vandenplaat Tourer.
And we have joining us at the desk our good friend Ralph Gio.
Very good
design.
Hello, Ralph.
FCA.
Johnny. Ed.
How's it been for you? How you doing?
Mind blowing. This show is so full of yummy, juicy stuff. I love the 35 Auburn Speedster. Is my favorite. The silver one.
That's
stunning.
Gorgeous. That was on the tour. That's an absolutely gorgeous car. Yeah.
How many years have you been coming?
Probably about 6 years, probably 7 years. But as a judge, about four times I've been.
Is it still fun? Is it still as exciting as it was?
It's nerve-wracking.
That's what
they're all perfect. I mean, the cars that make it to Pebble are really unbelievable. So, how do you judge?
And which class were you judging?
Something I know nothing about, which is the brass carriage.
Oh, we could have used you about 20 minutes ago.
Three times my age. Okay, 2.5.
Here comes our first place car in a lovely blue, a 1927 Bentley 3-liter Vandenplaat Sports Tourer. Similar to the last one, but this one is just a gorgeous machine.
I like the color on this. It's nice, refreshing to see. Just as it's refreshing to see a Ferrari not red, it's refreshing to see a Bentley not green.
Green. Right. Yeah, French blue.
So when tasked with an era that you're not familiar with, how do you approach it?
Go back to the basics, proportion. And a lot of the guys I was with, Tom Gills and our crew, we all stand back and look at just fundamental proportions.
Okay. Yeah.
So this car, interestingly enough, was owned by Ronald Hornby, son of the inventor of Meccano and Hornby model trains, which if you grew up in my part of the world were huge. You played with them as a kid, your model train set, you built cars out of Meccano. He was the first owner of this car. Terrific color, great little car.
I love
Here comes a pretty special class. This is the British pre-war sports cars, late. It's class K2. And so these were some of the things running around with the other great, you know, pre-war sports cars, the Alphas. Okay, here comes a third place car, 1934 SS Cars SSS 1 Tourer.
Now, do you have anything on the concept car one?
Not this year.
Not this year?
No. I take that back through Alpha. I keep forgetting. We have the 4C Alpha.
4C Spider, right?
Yeah, the Spider, brand new this year.
Can you keep track of all the brands that you're looking?
It's baptism by fire right now.
You know, what I love about you being here is that you are genuinely, I mean, everybody's a car guy, but I follow you on Instagram, I see your posts, you're posting up not just your own brand, you are posting up vehicles that you admire, classic vehicles, vintage vehicles, but even some modern ones too, and drawing parallels in design from old, you know, to modern. This has got to be nirvana for you, right?
It really is for a designer. I wish more of my young staff could come and see these cars because it was limitless back then. There was no real federal rules, lots of stuff like that.
Here's our second place car, 1938 Alvis Speed 25 Oxford & Sons open two-seater. And Ralph, we were just talking to Ian Callum, and we said, look, these things have, you know, like arrows sticking out of them in the front. What do you see here that you can take back to your studio and say...
I don't know how much liberty they've taken in the color restoration, but like there's a cell out there with a turquoise interior. You know, there was some daring going on back there that I think we're due for again. So stuff like that that we can do, you know, colors.
Yeah, and you guys do this stuff. I mean, you brought back the classic muscle car palette. You'd said the plum crazy Hellcats, or I should say Charger and Challengers. And so you guys, exterior color-wise, go real big.
And I go back to, you hear a lot of these cars were ordered by one person or two people. Today, as all automakers allow you to order their cars, but people don't have the patience to wait 3 months for their car, but they could just about get it any way they want.
And our winner.
This is our winner. This is quite an incredible car. 1937 Jaguar SS 100 Roadster from Mexico. And I don't know if you guys got the chance to see this car, but I think it's spectacular.
SS 100s are the most glamorous of the SS, which is, of course, what Jaguar was before the war.
That's right. So for, what was it?
Standard Swallow.
Standard Swallow, yes.
Sir William Lyons' company. Even back then, he had an eye for proportion, and it's just
gorgeous,
almost perfect for a late 1930s car.
I mean, you know, the classic design motifs, long hood, short deck, there's your actual dictionary definition of it.
This class is interesting, too. We just had the Alvis, you know, that's a name that's long gone. Alvis started in Coventry in 1919 and became a subsidiary of Rover in 1965. AC was also in this class, and Lagonda. They're names that are, AC, of course, their car became the basis for the Cobra. And Lagonda, Aston Martin's bringing that back, Johnny.
Yep. Now, Ralph, I asked Ian when he was up here, you know, as a car guy, you obviously have to love the whole segment, but you have an era that you probably, when that time period comes into play, you start to really perk up. What era does it for you?
I love the early 60s Italian cars, the Ferraris, the Alphas of those times. The Maseratis were just stunning. And that's when they were discovering real freeform metalwork. And it's gorgeous. And the race cars.
Did you see the barn find, the 61, the black one with the dent in the rear?
Gorgeous car.
Should it have been dusted? We'll get back to that question in a second. We have our L1 pre-war preservation, 1904 Pope Hartford Model Beer rear entrance tonneau.
I don't know if you can hear this thing, but it sounds like it's firing at about every 12 feet as it chugs up onto the ramp here.
This is chitty, chitty, bang, bang.
60 RPM.
Is this something you judge? No.
Not quite that old.
Not quite that old.
So do you feel they should have dusted that barn find short wheelbase?
I don't think so, because it really underscored the effect of
Frank Marcus, if you're listening or watching, see, I told you were wrong. They should not have dusted it. Thank you, Ralph.
That's how I would drive it. I would drive it that way, not even fix the dent. I'd love it.
Never wash it.
I think it's amazing. The preservation class is actually reasonably new, and it's becoming a crowd favorite because people love the idea that these cars have survived. And to your point earlier, Ralph, about, you know, the taking liberties with color, you can actually get a real sense of what they looked like back then.
Because they had black and white film. I mean, you don't know what the color really was.
Yeah.
And it makes them relatable, I think, too. It's like, I have a dirty car. They have a dirty car. You know.
Exactly.
Here's our second place car, 1927 Hispano Suites, a Type 49 H.J. Mulliner Sports Saloon. Hispano Suites are always a Concours favorite. They're big, they're bold, they're elegant. They have V12s a lot of the time. And this one is no exception.
Interesting combination, as the name suggests, of Spanish and Swiss. So Hispano, Spain was the money, and Suiza in the form of Mark Birkett was the talent, the Swiss engineer. Hispano Suiza built not only great cars, but also built aircraft engines. And
well, this one's neat too, because it's not only is it Swiss, but it's also H.J. Mulliner, so it's got British coachwork.
Again, that's the way the era was.
So we'll thank Ralph for coming on. Appreciate the time.
Very much.
Keep having
this.
Fun.
Speaking of non-relatable cars, there's a winner, 1906 Pierce Great Arrow, 40, 45, 7-passenger touring. And that's really a stunning vehicle. Look at that thing. Talk about brass.
There is a bit of an irony here in that... back in 1955, Phil Hill's restored 1931 Pierce Arrow set the tone for Pebble Beach Concours car classes. Now we have a car that hasn't been restored at all.
Okay, here we have class L2. This is the post-war preservation class. And sorry, we're scrambling here with a little bit of paperwork. Everything's coming in fast and furious. But we've got, look at this, there's a Porsche. This is a post-war car, 1965 Porsche 356 SC Carmen Coupe.
And we're joined by our good friend, Dan Neal from the Wall Street Journal, one of the honorary judges here. This is your, how many years have you been doing this?
I think this is five.
Five years. And of course, we had our famous night years ago where...
Yes?
Oh, I'll tell that story later. But anyways, good to see you, Dan. How
actually,
are you?
And let's talk about our bet for today. And I would note that the Isotta won first in class. And what was it that you're favoring that got third in class? Was it the Austra Daimler?
I said I was leaning towards it, but eventually I said that the Isotta is going to win.
I see you've hedged your bets on that. Very good.
Yeah. Right. He came out and told me that he thought the Isotta would be the winner.
Oh, I believe that Johnny's right on that.
And here we have the second place car in the class. It's a great sounding car, 1956 Maserati A6G 2000 Frua Coupe. And wow, how'd you like to find this in a barn?
Yeah, I love the way this one looks. A lot of people are talking about it. The paint job, the finish, not restoring it, just cleaning it up.
So, Dan, what class were you judging today?
I had Ferrari competition.
Ferrari competition.
And it was a lot of old friends. I was touring with Derek Bell, and he saw a lot of cars that he knew and had driven. So it was a good experience. I enjoyed it. We saw some beautiful cars, and I was leaning toward the 250 LM. But
really?
I don't know where we are on that.
I think like our other Ferrari bet, you're wrong. And here comes our winner of this class, the L2 class, post-war preservation, 1956 Jaguar D-Type Roadster. Is there anything lovelier than a D-Type?
No, and this star has a fascinating history.
It's just gone straight through the...
Oh, it's a stop-and-go penalty through the ramp there.
Missing its brakes a little bit.
Yeah.
What were you saying is an interesting history?
Well, there's a D-Type out there that started with... it was never raced in road racing. It was drag raced in the United States for several years by its owner. But I see the other one won.
Okay. Well, up next, Dan, you were judging Ferrari.
Yes.
We have our M1 class. This is Ferrari Grand Touring.
Yep.
This is your class. So yep. I have the results in front of me, and obviously the car you picked is not even in top three. So once again, good job.
Thank you. Thank you.
How many years of that is not even picking a car that manages to get a bronze?
I take a certain amount of pride in being way out of the ballpark.
So you're saying the $20 is as good as mine?
Oh, no, I feel real strong about today.
Okay, Dan, thanks for joining us, and we'll have you next time back next year, hopefully.
All right, very good.
Thank you, Dan.
Thank you, Dan.
Okay, here comes Ferrari Grand Touring. Here's our third place car. 1960 Ferrari 400 Super America Pininfarina Coupe Aerodinamico Prototipo.
And yes, this car has brakes, unlike the D-types. So it actually stopped on top of the ramp. Interesting car, this too, with the lights hidden away. Unusual for a Ferrari of this era. And joining us on the desk, welcome to Alan de Cadenet. Alan, you've probably driven more of these cars than the rest of us put together.
I seem to have spent a lot of my life driving in Ferraris of one sort or another. So, you may well be correct.
What do you think of our third place winner, Alan?
Which one?
This one right here, the one driving off.
Oh, that's an exciting prototype car because basically it's one of the first cars to have the aerodynamic lighting at the front. Cord had that before the war, but that's interesting. They slide sideways, the headlights pop up, and hopefully you can see where you're going.
And then our second place car coming up onto the stage right now is the 1958 Ferrari 250 GT long wheelbase Scaglietti Spider California.
Well, the California Spiders were specially built, all aluminum body. Scaglietti is a body shop just outside Modena. And this is a long wheelbase, so it was built on the Tour de France chassis, and which first won the Tour de France 1957. Very exciting little car. Both the long wheelbase, like this one, and the short wheelbase, California Spiders. Spiders, just an Italian way of saying two-seater open sports car, have become very popular. But look at it. A car like that with its headlights fared in is the one that everybody wants.
Yeah. Do you like short wheelbase or long wheelbase? Do you have a preference?
Well, the short wheelbase is a really good car for twisty, mountainous roads. And the long wheelbase is just a bit more stable at high speed. That's the only difference, really.
And here's our winner. This is the 1957 Ferrari 250 GT Pininfarina Cabriolet Series 1. This is the winner of the M1, the Ferrari Grand Touring class. And Alan, do you have any insights on this one or anything else Ferrari?
Yeah, that is you have to look at the car, and first thing you realize is what a beautiful car it is. The Pininfarina did two series of these cabriolet. That's just a French word for having the hood down. And they have become very, very popular indeed. They're not as valuable as the California Spiders, but they are catching them up.
And maybe after this they are.
Right.
Well, you know, that's a very good thing to say, because whatever happens here today affects the marketplace tomorrow.
Absolutely.
As dealers all watching this, and anyone's got one of these in stock, forget the figure you were offered it at this morning.
Right.
Tomorrow it's different.
Here we've got our next Ferrari class. That's M2 Ferrari Competition.
Ferrari is
and
one of those
real quick,
marks.
Angus, here's our third place. It's 1959 Ferrari 250 GT long wheelbase Scaglietti Spider California Competizione, which is a mouthful, but gorgeous, gorgeous car.
Look how popular these cars are. We're seeing very similar types of open two-seater car. Well, look, we're in California. It's a lovely, bright, sunny day. Can you think of a nicer thing to do than jump in this and get friendly with someone on a nice long-distance road trip?
Do you think there are more Ferraris here this year than almost any other mark?
Yes, because of what happened last year when a Ferrari wins best of class, and also that's kind of the chosen mark this year. They decided that this would be a year to honor Ferrari because of what happened last year. We wins the best of show.
Here's our second place car. It's a 1956 Ferrari 250 GT Alloy Buono K.
Well, the Signor Buono was the head of the Ghia design company, and he built what was has become known as the Buono Coupe. That's an all-aluminium body. It's quite a pretty little car. However, these are the kind of cars that we used to take the engines out when I was younger to replace your blown-up engine in your GTO or your short wheelbase. We didn't think a whole lot of them back then, but hey, look what's happening now. You know, it's a big deal car, and deservedly so. It's a pretty machine.
And here comes our winner.
Would you like to announce the winner?
Yes, the winner is a 1960, it's a Ferrari 250 GT short wheelbase Scaglietti Berlinetta Competizione, which means basically that it's got a lightweight aluminum body, it's got a hot-dogged engine with camshafts and carburetors on it, but it's still part of the famous Ferrari 250 GT series. That was the series that put Ferrari on the map. He made so many different types of car in that series that it put him on the map big time.
I thought walking around this morning, I thought this was one of the prettiest cars here. Maybe not, you know, the most elegant or the Concours d'Elegance, but I just thought just in terms of I like looking at you.
And I think if you're a modern Ferrari fan and you don't know much about this era, you can look and you can see the details in that are on the modern cars. The duct in the front, you know.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, this is why people love these brands, is that the history that they carry forward from
it's a very usable, drivable car. Rallies, races, going shopping, whatever you want to do, that is a good Ferrari to do it in.
Exactly.
So our next class coming up, Ferraris in the Pebble Beach Road Races, and Alan, I find it amazing that in the 1950s, a little road race through the Del Monte Forest here could attract some world-class racing machinery.
Well, it did, because quite simply, nobody wants to come second, and you want the best car you can have to come first, don't you?
Here's our third-place car. This 1955 Ferrari 857S Scaglietti Spider. And then again, another, I thought, just super great-looking car.
Well, it's a very sexy machine. It's minimalistic. You've got just a very smooth, low-drag body over a tubular frame. It's got a big four-cylinder engine in there. Not all Ferraris had 12 cylinders of this.
And that's they the key four. Point. This is a four-cylinder.
Yeah.
And it's got the cool, the D-type sort of fin.
Yes. You see, the aerodynamics are a bit of a black art those days, but if you multiply 857 by 4, you will get the cylinder capacity of the engine, because each number represents the cylinder capacity of one cylinder.
I'll take your word for that, because math is really not why I'm
no.
here.
I just thought I'd mention that.
I was wondering about the name, actually. I was wondering where they got 857 from.
Well, that's a tradition that continues. The new Ferrari 488 GTB.
Yes.
488 cubic centimeters is the capacity of each cylinder. Multiplied
exactly
by 8,
right.
3.9 liters.
Yeah.
Here's our second place car, 1952 Ferrari 340 Mexico Vignale Spider. Double winner. It also won the Phil Hill Cup.
Can you talk about why... What's Ferrari's connection with? They use the word Mexico or Panamericana. There's a connection to this continent with the brand.
The Carrera Panamericana road race ran from the very south of Mexico all the way up through the country. It was to celebrate the opening of the Pan American Highway. When Ferrari produced special lightweight Berlinettas closed cars or open sports cars for that race, they were named after the race. They became the Mexico Berlinetta or the Mexico Spider. And that is exactly what we have here. That one's got a Bertone body on it, I think. Pretty looking car, too.
Sounds lovely.
Sounds great, too.
And I love that our winner is not a red Ferrari.
Right.
Yes.
Any color as long as it's not red.
Something about a non-red Ferrari.
What have we
here
got winning
here? We've got a 1954 Ferrari 500 Mondial.
Oh, the Mondial.
Spider,
yeah.
Series 1.
Yeah. Well, this is kind of a junior formula Ferrari. You see, it's only got a 2-liter four-cylinder engine, identical to the Formula 2 engine they had in the sort of Formula 2 Grand Prix cars. But they were cheaper, but a great place to practice your racecraft was in the cockpit of one of these. And, as you say, nice to see one that isn't Ferrari red for a change.
They really stand out when they're not Ferrari red. I heard a very interesting story that modern Formula One cars have V6 engines, which everyone derides for their sound in their hybrid powertrains, because Ferrari specifically refused to contemplate a four-cylinder engine until someone did remind Luca de Montezemolo that actually there are an awful lot of four-cylinder racing Ferraris.
Yes. And he made an awful lot of V6s, of course, called Dino engines after his late son, who died way too early in life, sadly.
Well, the rumour is, of course, the V6 Formula One cars are... Ferrari is contemplating doing a V6 road car called the Dino mid-engine sports car to come in below the Ferrari 488.
Would help get the volume up of another model.
Exactly. It's a sort of entry-level Ferrari. I think all manufacturers have entry-level something or other, don't they? Get you hooked, and then they go for the big stuff.
Yeah. There's a difference between entry-level and cheap, though.
Well, yes. Priced right, I think, is the modern way of saying that.
So we've got now, we've got a...
This is designed by Touring.
Yes.
Italian large design class, spans a couple decades here. Italian coach builder, waiting on her third place car.
Yes, it was a Signor Andrea Loni who was the boss of Touring, and he was always competing with Zagato. And in 1931, Zagato had some financial problems, and Touring were given work because they couldn't go to Zagato by Alfa Romeo. And some of the bodywork that Touring produced was some of the best in the world. I have a 1931 Touring bodied Alfa Romeo myself, and I've had it for 44 years. It's my favorite thing in the whole world. I love it. Once you have one of those, you never let it go.
Yeah, it's the Touring bodies too. The way they built the cars was unique too, wasn't it? With the
That's exactly right. Super leggera. They put little thin tubes all the way around. Put the panels on the top. And they carried that through all the way from when they started up to the 1960s Aston Martins. They're still doing it today.
So we've got a Lamborghini. It's pretty cool to see a Lamborghini actually up on the ramp. You know, it's always Ferrari, 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 and this is the early one.
You're right.
The first GT. I think that's cool because I've always loved Lamborghinis.
Well, front engined as well, you see.
Yeah, absolutely.
It shows you what Pebble Beach is about. It's not what's necessarily the big deal, famous model of a mark. It's the best example, the most elegant, whatever example of the mark that they happen to find. In this case, hey, we got a front engine one.
Right, and it also helps us the very first Lamborghini, which is of course created specifically to take on Ferrari and maybe personally take on Enzo. So great.
Well, that's
history.
Right. Yeah. I mean, when the Miura first came out, we all sat back and went, oh, unbelievable. Transverse V12 in the back of the Lamborghini. It was fantastic.
That's where the word supercar was coined, someone looking at the Miura.
That's right.
GK set right.
Yeah.
Second place car, 1931 Alfa Romeo 6C 1750 Grand Sport Touring Spider. And this one was, I think, the first car I saw this morning, and one of the prettiest.
Knockout car.
Absolutely.
It was specially built for the Villa d'Este Concours at Lake Como. I thought this car could even possibly be a best of show because it's so pretty and beautiful.
I felt the same way.
You see, that's the impartiality. If we were judging, this would be class winner and up for best of show.
Absolutely. And if we're sounding a little bit of confusion, then one, we seem to have lost the preservation class Ferraris. They haven't appeared. And then in the touring class, we were expecting a Pegaso. We ended up with a Lamborghini on the ramp. So
maybe it didn't start.
It
don't know.
May not have started, which of course.
Or it's a typo.
Major criteria. If you don't start, you don't get, do you?
Right, exactly.
It's happened a lot before that.
Yeah. Imagine getting, you know you're in the final three and your car could be there. And even, and the judge points to you and it won't fire up.
Well, what's happened is quite often people start the car early just to make sure it's going to start, we're going to get there. They switch off. The sun gets on the old carburetor, vaporizes the fuel, and guess what? Won't start when you come to really need it. People getting hernias pushing and shoving these cars, trying to get them to go.
it's a problem that doesn't happen much these days with fuel-injected cars, and that basically you just push the button and they go, don't they? It's not something you think about anymore.
Well, you have a thing called a hot start in an aircraft where you give it full throttle, crank it, and then it goes. But if you try on the regular throttle, it won't work. Same with a car.
Here's our first place car. This is another lovely one. The 39 Alfa Romeo 6C 2500 Touring Coupe. And Ed, you were kind of drooling over this one this morning, and the blue one.
I love the 6Cs. I love this era of Alfa Romeo. I mean, this has swagger. I mean, it's so bold looking. I mean, it's so impressive coming down the street.
And it's exactly what Alan was talking about. Where Pebble Beach, you know, what's the best one Alfa Romeo? It's a, you know, post-war spider or whatever. But I mean, this is something you should know about Alfa Romeo.
Right. Especially this car. It's got a fabulous racing history, and it only got built, really. It's the last car that Mr. Ferrari himself actually helped to build before he left Alfa Romeo.
Oh,
they got rid of him, but this is one of his last cars. It's got three early Weber carburetors on there. You don't see those very often. It's a rare machine. The guy found it in Italy. I was talking to him, and it's taken him about 12 years to get it all together, up and running and here.
And just for what, he must be feeling quite proud to have won a class.
Gorgeous.
It's quite an achievement here at Pebble Beach to take home a class.
Very.
Well, it looks like we found the Ferrari preservation class, which is an interesting idea. Some of these cars have been lovingly kept for many, many years. You'd like to think that if you had the money to buy a Ferrari, you wouldn't really want to let it go unless you had a very good reason.
Well, only to move on to a better one, perhaps. You know, I mean, philosophically, you should try to keep things that are the best they can possibly be for as long as possible. I've had my old Omega wristwatch here for 1965, bought it on the way to the Nürburgring. I was sitting having dinner with Pete Conrad. He had one too, only his had been to the moon.
Right.
Worth a bit more than mine that's only been to the Nürburgring.
Oh, look.
Oh, stunner. This is a third place car in the Ferrari preservation class, a 1966 Ferrari 275 GTB / C Scaglietti Berlinetta.
Unbelievable car. That has a dry sump engine for the oil tank. It's a competition. It's a 275 GTB, but stroke C for competizione. One of these cars, sister car to this one, won the class for the GT cars at Le Mans 66 and came, I think, sixth overall. This is a sister car, and it's a delicious thing. It's in its own juice, as the French would say, like a piece of old roast beef with a V12 engine in it.
What's the color? What do you know about that?
Well, it's a faded Ferrari red,
I knew it.
And it's got NART, North American Racing Team stripes on it. That was Luigi Canetti's race team.
Right.
And here's our second place car in the preservation. Ferrari preservation class, 1961 Ferrari 400 Super America Pininfarina short wheelbase coupe, yeah. Being pushed.
Well, that is a car, you see, that Ferrari was asked to build big engine cars by Canetti because Americans like grunt. They don't want, you know, woofy put sort of little things like we like in Europe. They want cars with big engines.
Right.
So that is a big engine car with probably well over 300 horsepower. They didn't make a lot of them, but they are very popular. Came long wheelbase, of course, came short wheelbase.
He's getting a helping hand off the ramp here.
Yep. Yeah, Alan, you want to announce the winner here in just a second once it gets underway?
Yeah, I will. Very pleased to do so. Oh, I'm not surprised this car won it too. Yeah, what we have coming up is a 1964 Ferrari 250 GTL for Lusso Scaglietti Berlinetta. Lusso being Italian for luxury. Some say the prettiest car that Ferrari ever made.
Really?
Yes, I would agree on that.
I go back and forth. Is it short wheelbase, 250 GT short wheelbase Spider, or is it Lusso? It depends on the time of day.
This car has the best parts of a GTO competition chassis underneath it, but it's still just part of the 250 GT series. So it's got three carbureted engine, about 250, maybe 60 horsepower. They haul pretty good. But the best thing, I think, is that it's a really pretty car. It's one of those sort of ageless looks that sometimes, you know, people... It's Pininfarina design.
Right. And Steve McQueen, of course, owned one that was a metallic brown, which I think is the most so beautiful cool. of them all.
Well, so anything cool. Steve owned, you know, it's all right by me.
Exactly, he had taste. Well, Alain de Cardenet, thank you very much for joining us and giving us your expertise on Ferraris. Yeah. And we hope you come back and join us next year here at Pebble Beach Concours.
It's been my pleasure, gentlemen. And bon continuation, as the French would say.
Thanks, Alain.
Thank you.
Thank you, Alain.
So, 01, class 01, which is post-war.
The early BB2s had the three-piece radiator grille.
And our third place car, of course, 1950 Aston Martin DB2 sedan.
And joining us...
Or saloon, this is a coupe.
Joining us at the desk, Hurley Haywood, America's most celebrated, winningest endurance racer. Hurley, it's good to see you since Le Mans, right? How have you been?
I know. It's been really good. It was good to see you in Le Mans. We had a good success over there.
Yes, we did.
Yeah, congrats on the win. That was pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, it was really exciting to see that develop. You know, last year we weren't too competitive, and then this year we just killed them out of the box, so it was good.
Fantastic.
Here comes real quick our second place car. It's a 1946 Delahaye 135 MS Porteur Coupe Aerodynamique.
The French is getting better, Johnny, I must say.
This Tupal Francais. My German's horrible. This gorgeous car.
Yeah, absolutely gorgeous car. One of those over-the-top French cars, of course, appropriate for a Delahaye. One of the old French brands, too, Delahaye. Been around since the 1890s, I believe.
And it's always interesting to see. Oh.
You're a hardcore racer. You've come to Pebble a few times.
Yep.
Do these cars resonate with you? Are you more the historics guy running at the racetrack, or do you appreciate the vehicles that come across the stage?
Well, when I walked the field this morning, I mean, I was just blown away by how many beautiful cars there were out there. And I don't care if you're talking about a completely unrestored car to the most highly restored car out there. Each one has a beautiful element to it. And it's hard, if you're an automobile guy, it's just almost impossible to not enjoy something like this. It's just an unbelievable show.
Like the one that's coming across the stage now, our second place winner.
A lot of people were talking about this car. This is actually our first place winner. This is the 1953 Abarth 1100 Sport Ghia Coupe.
Now, this is fascinating because the bodywork is believed to be the work of Giovanni Michelotti, with heavy influences from Virgil Exner. Of course, Virgil Exner was the man behind the forward look at Chrysler in the 1950s. And this looks just like a 1950s car. I think this could be a bit of a sleeper, this one.
Yep. Could be, absolutely. For sure. And you see the Exner. I mean, it just the... I don't know, almost the puffiness that he could do, but still very elegant. It's not bloated; it's just kind of pushed out.
I like that. I like that car a lot. I think it's terrific. It appeared on the Ghia stand actually, alongside the Dodge Fire Arrow that Ghia had built for.
We have our next class real quick. 02. This is the post-war late class. Here's third place, 1957 Ciata 208S Moto Spider. Very cool car.
Do you have a favorite out here on the
lawn? It's hard to pick a favorite. I mean, every one is special. I kind of liked, when I first walked into the field, the very first car I looked at was in the Rolls-Royce class, and it was the Italian-bodied Rolls. And there was something about the color, the shape, the interior that just really stood out to me. So I don't know. That, to me, was really a sensational-looking car.
This little Seat looks a lot like a baby Ferrari, doesn't it?
Very cute. Oh, here's these next two are very cool. But here's our second place car, 1954 Fiat HV Zagato Coupe. And it's hard to talk about these cars without talking about the name. It's an 8V instead of a V8, 2-liter V8. Fiat thought Ford owned the copyright to V8. So they said, well, let's call it an 8V instead. And that's where the car got their name. They made very few of these, but they're just stunning cars.
And the name's coming back. Zagato has been bandied about for a possible return of a modern a sports car. And you can see why. It's got such a history.
And Zagato, of course, I mean, they're a place in history. I still think one of the most beautiful cars of all time is the Aston Martin, the DB4 Zagato.
Right.
Especially they did there's a blue one that Aston owns. I just think.
Yeah, we had a polished aluminum bodied car as a Zagato that Dan Davis owned that was just sensational looking.
And here's our first place, the winner of the post-war late class, 1954 Fiat, another 8V supersonic Ghia coupe. So Ghia, like Zagato, is a coach builder, and you can see the exaggerated proportions. And Angus and I heard something interesting about this car on the Tour d'Elegance. The owner, those bumpers was his personal signature. So whatever car he would buy would get these bumpers. And they're pretty nuts when you look at them up close. They're multi-layered. And
he was a guy called Lou Fagioli. He was a businessman and a hydroplane racer. So I think he thought he would put a bit of his hydroplaning expertise on this car. But you can see why he did it, because there are no bumpers on that car, and this car was actually used as a daily commuter for many, many years.
And coming straight on, it looks all right. It's not safety bumpers from the 70s bad.
No, well, nothing's quite safety bumpers from the 70s bad.
I think we have some cars here that...
But Hurley, you might know a bit of...
I might know a few things about what's coming next. There were some cars, some Porsches, vintage racing vehicles out on the lawn. Had you driven any of them, the RSK? Have you done any of the stuff for the museum?
No. No? I did not drive any of the cars in the field, but the one that really caught my eye was the one with the big wing on it.
Yes.
So that was a 550 with a wing on it, and that looked pretty sensational.
Porsche.
Yeah. But I don't ever remember that car running anywhere. I mean,
This is the new class 03 post-war racing. Here's our third place cars on the ramp right now, a 1959 Lister Kosten Roadster.
So Brian Lister was a racing car designer, and Frank Kosten was an aerodynamicist, and they worked together more than once. And Jaguar engines, of course, were the go-to powertrain in the late 50s for sports car builders.
And Hurley, the car you were just talking about, which I saw on the tour and I thought was just mind-blowingly cool, it's our second place car, and it's a 1955 Porsche 550 RS Spyder, known as the first winged Porsche because it literally has an airplane wing above the driver.
Did you know that wing was also self-adjustable? You could adjust it with a ratchet on the wing.
And it's interesting, too, to get in and out of the car, you actually have to flip the wing up vertical because it's the only way to get in or out of the car. But it's just, there it is. Yep, just went upright. I think it's just such a neat thing. And I guess it's known as the first winged Porsche, which I think is pretty cool, too.
The wing's almost bigger than the entire car. You wonder how much downforce it actually generated, because those supports don't look too strong, do they?
But if you think about Porsche,
or where the downforce was, that's right in the middle of the car, you know.
But on a, on Porsche's weights in the back, you need downforce elsewhere.
Yeah.
And an obvious winner, 1965 Shelby Cobra Daytona Coupe is our first place in the post-war racing. Books have been written about this car. It's one of my all-time absolute favorite cars.
Love the shape. Peter Brock designs.
Unbelievable. That's right. 23-year-old Peter Brock designed this car. No one thought it would work, and it went to Le Mans and beat Enzo Ferrari and the 250 GTO at their own game. Over 180 miles an hour on the Mulsanne Straight in 1965. Incredible car.
Incredible car indeed. And Hurley, we'd like to thank you very much for joining us, taking time out.
It's been my pleasure. Thanks.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
As the Daytona Coupe comes off the stand, we're getting ready for the Cunninghams, and we'd like to welcome another guest, a good friend of ours, Mr. Ken Gross. Ken, journalist, historian, hot rodder. And Ken, how many Pebble Beaches have you done now? 26.
Yeah.
So here we've got our first place 1952 Cunningham C4R Competition Roadster.
And pretty cool car, this one, the definitive Cunningham for me.
Well, really, you know, Briggs Cunningham was, when I was a kid, he was the American who was going to win Le Mans in his own cars. And the C4 was a monster compared to anything they raced in that era. A big Hemi motor with four carburetors. I mean, we thought that was the cat's you-know-what.
Well, it is that a quintessentially American, you know, lots of muscle. Briggs Cunningham himself, too, was he was like the all-American sports star, sort of like Ernest Hemingway with real manners.
Well, he really was, because he won the America's Cup as a yachtsman.
In his own yacht.
In his own yacht. He built his own cars in West Palm Beach, Florida. I mean, nobody in that era.
Legend. Now coming to the stage is a second place finisher, the 1954 Cunningham C3 Vignale Coupe.
And you know that this was the way they were going to try to make some money for the race cars. They built, I want to say, 18 or 19 C3 Vignale bodied coupes in the hopes that that would pay off this huge investment in racing.
Sort of like everyone was trying to do the Enzo Ferrari model.
True. I mean, you have a cool name, you put it on a car, and you hope you win races.
Right. There's a few people still trying that today, too.
Yeah. Well, there's what's Glickenhaus is trying to do it with the same car. One car for both.
Yeah. I would never underestimate Jim Glickenhaus, by the way.
I'm not underestimating anyone.
Right.
Ken, you want to introduce the class winner here?
Right. This is the winning car in the class, T.G. Mittler. His family has owned great cars for many years. It's a 51 Cunningham C2. The C2 was almost the prototype racer for Cunninghams. And this is a beautiful example of a very sexy car.
Now, for those not familiar with Cunningham, with a vehicle like this and the way it drives, what would you say is the modern interpretation, if possible? Is it like a... It must be like a Miata with a Viper motor or something in it, right?
Or like a Viper.
This is an animal. I mean, it's got a 354 Hemi in it, lightweight Italian-built chassis and body. I, as a hot rodder, if I put a Hemi in a Miata, we might be close.
Well, speaking of hot rods, Ken, one of your great achievements, I think, is getting hot rods onto the lawn at Pebble Beach in the Concours d'Elegance, and I think... You probably played a big role in this next cast, getting that here, Mercury Customs, something very near and dear to us here at Motor Trend.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, some of these cars were featured in Motor Trend back in the day. It hasn't been easy to have custom cars at Pebble. These cars are almost the antithesis of a Fagoni or so forth, but they have their own style, their own elegance, their own specialty.
And we've got our third place winner in the Mercury Customs class, a 1950 Mercury OCM Wally Welch Custom Coupe. And cool.
This is a really interesting car because it started out with the Ayala brothers in East Los Angeles. It was on the cover of Hop Up in 1952 with DeSoto grill bars, but with spaces in the bars. So it looked like a guy who had the bad end of a fight. When the Barris brothers took it over and painted it maroon like this, they put in a couple of extra grill teeth. It gave it respectability.
Now, the second place vehicle is one near and dear to all of us at Motor Trend because it did grace the cover of the 1951 December issue in a beautiful Winter Wonderland motif.
Right.
It's the 1949 Mercury 9CM Sam Barris Custom Coupe. And what do you know?
This is arguably the first chop Mercury. Sam Barris bought this car in 1948, and they say he just looked at it for a week or two, walked around it, checked it out, and then hacked 4 inches out of the front corners and maybe 5 out of the back. What he did that no one had done, not only was it the first Mercury, but he took that little dog leg in the side spear, lathered it with lead, and made it a straight line all the way to the back.
A hugely influential car in terms of customizing.
Absolutely.
I can point him out as a witness, but this is the winner here is the one I picked to win this class. What this is, first of all, the owner is one of the nicest people I've ever met.
Right. Right. Listen, Jim McNeil bought this car when he was 16 years old. It was built in 1951 by George Barris for a Nisei American named Bob Hirohata. He bought the car new, took it to Barris, and said, do something fabulous. So the Barris has hardtopped this car because Mercury didn't make a hardtop in 1951. They removed the B-pillars, built a beautiful low rill, painted it lime green, and it starred in Running Wild with Mamie Van Doren. It is the definitive car, and Jim McNeil, who owns it, bought it at age 16, has owned it all this time.
That's incredible.
Is this the definitive Mercury Custom, in
I
your
opinion?
I think
so, too. We've given it both the first place in class and the Dean Batchelor Memorial Award as the most significant custom car. It just doesn't get better than this.
Fabulous car.
Phenomenal. It's just long and low, and it's everything.
So what does, when they're looking at the hot rods, they're looking for authenticity on those cars. So we're looking for cars that were as they were modified back in 1950, 1949.
Right. Nothing in this class is older than 1959 in terms of modifications. They're all historic customs, and I'm personally thrilled to have them here.
Well, you know a lot about this class too, Ken, I would guess.
Yeah, I worked on the selection committee to get these cars.
50th anniversary class. Sorry to cut you off there, Ken. Just want to get this out. This is the third place car, 65 Shelby Mustang, Ford Shelby Mustang, GT350. They're all going to be GT350s, but...
they are. And then our selection committee people were saying, gosh, they all look alike. But, you know, Carroll Shelby built these cars in Torrance. They kind of took them off the line. They have 306 horsepower modified motors, upgraded suspension, windows that drop down so the air flows through the car. And they're just bitching to drive.
How do you... I walked the field and I saw all of them. For the judges, what are they looking for? They all look perfect.
You're absolutely right, and it's very difficult to judge this class. There are little nuances of the right bolts, the right hose clamps. That's what they have to do because they are all alike. But history bears a part, too. You know, we have three discretion points for provenance, history, impact, and that's probably what makes the difference.
Here's our second place car. This is a very cool one. This is a GT350 prototype.
Right.
So why is this what's special?
Well, the prototype is the first car, in essence. You know, Shelby was a great convincer of people to do things. And he went to Ford Motor Company. I mean, he could sell refrigerators to Eskimos. And he basically said to Ford, I can do these cars better than you can. And they said, then have at it.
Right. Ford at that time wasn't interested in building specialized one-off vehicles. They were trying to sell to the masses, so they gave it to a specialist like Carroll Shelby.
Right. Well, and the...
Look at this.
And, you know, it sounds good, too. Still sounds like a great American muscle car. Here comes our winner on the ramp, a 65 Ford Shelby Mustang GT350. What's noteworthy about this one?
Oh, this is John Otsbeck's car, and this is about as accurate as it possibly gets. And, you know, the great thing about these GT350s, if you were 25 years old in 1965 and you had 25 cents a mile to spend, you could rent one of these cars. I wasn't old enough in 65, and I was so envious. You could go to Hertz, and while this isn't a Hertz, rent-a-racer, as they called it, you could race one. Guys actually took them to the track, ran them, and brought them back to Hertz. Gee, you didn't put much mileage on this car. No, but it was really fast at high revs.
And the good thing about the Hertz cars, of course, is that while the Shelby GT350s were all Wimbledon white with the blue, the Shelby cars were black with the gold stripes. And I'm torn as to which one actually looks better.
Well, and they also built a few red ones, which were also fairly sharp. We have one in the class down there, but obviously it didn't make the cut. But Carroll Shelby's influence for Ford performance is endless and enduring, and this is a nice example.
Well, the factory at Torrance wasn't far from where our office is now, and of course, just as the car fires up, it sounds great. Classic, iconic Shelby number on that too, number 98 on that car.
Fight the Cobra Racer is what, $7.98.99.
Whoa, listen to this thing. Healthy. Ken, it was a real pleasure.
I want to thank you, Ken.
Great
so
to
much.
Be with you, gents.
And I'd like to thank you for getting those Mercuries in because, I mean,
it's amazing.
Real quick, because we get a little break here. The
pleasure is mine.
If I can keep you on for one more second, I just want to say, you know, the winning car, the lime green one, the, you know, you look at that hard side with that deco kind of, you know, stainless graphic, and you look at, like, that Bugatti that was out there. Boy, there's not really that much difference, and it's wonderful that you got them here.
Well, I think people have been at that class all day long, and it's very gratifying.
So, what can we see more? Because, Ken, you've bought hot rods here. We've had custom Mercuries now. I mean, they are very important elements in the development of the automobile, and, you know, automobile's influence on pop culture. And California was very much that epicenter of that movement. Is there something else to come now? Are we going to see Dry Lakes races or something like that?
We did Bonneville cars. We might do racers in the future. I mean, it isn't my decision. It might be my recommendation. I'd like to surprise people, but Jay Heumann a few years ago, who was the Concours chairman for years, he said, if we can't have cars like these hot rods recognize their contribution to American racing, then we shouldn't be in this business. So I'd say watch this space.
Well, can I put a vote in for Indianapolis Roadsters, please?
Oh, we had them 2 years ago, but we'll have them again.
All right, thanks very much, Ken. Great to have you with us, and we'll see you again next year.
Thank you.
Okay, so that's all the class awards. I hope you've been keeping track, because one of those cars is going to be our best of show winner. I mentioned earlier, of course, that Pebble Beach is very big in terms of raising money for charity. You saw the check there for $1.8 million going to charity. What's happening now is that the votes are still being counted, and as we heard, some of the discussions among the judges are pretty intense.
Over the life of the event. That's
Jay Leno now on stage, commenting on the fact that the award Concours has raised more than $20 million now. So Jay, of course, quietly warming up the crowd, as is his... As his usual style, and we're joined by Dave Merrick from Acura.
As I fix myself,
I like that he's keeping the brimmed hat on. Yeah, that's what we couldn't wear.
Well done.
How you guys doing?
Good. So Dave, how many years have you been doing judging?
My first year.
I heard you were nervous.
No, that's not. You know what? I don't ever get nervous. Press conference, whatever. They all freak out because I'll say something bad. But literally today, it seems more important or something. It's like, oh, my gosh. These are billionaires. But as soon as I got here, and I was judging with Ian Callum, and, you know, it's all the guys I know. So as soon as I got sitting down, I was like, okay, this is good. I was nervous. I didn't wear a tie.
You look great.
Like, you know what? But, once I got into the actual looking at the cars and saying proportion and feel and things, that, you know, I was home. But it's a little daunting when you're around, it's Stirling Moss. I'm like, holy crap.
I mean, if you're a car guy you come to this place, you don't know where to look first.
You're doing backflips, you know. It's like, yeah, it's stunning.
So what was your personal favorite of the show being so far?
We were, I love race cars, but I think the Lusso was just stunning, and it's hard not to like it. It's good when it came over, and I was like, oh my god! But the silver, the Mercedes, the race cars are easy to run and look at.
Sure.
Well, you know, 722, as these guys well known, is if there was one car in the world that I could drive, it would be that one.
They started it up when I was standing there. I was like, oh, crap. And I turned around to see if it was Sterling, because he had been in the building. I thought, how often would that be awesome? But he wasn't. But
what's amazing about that car, real quick, is, you know, not only is that the car, but that's the engine.
Yeah.
That's the transmission.
Yeah. It's all.
That's complete. It never had to go.
Are we on cable? It's the shit.
It is. It is. And that's totally fine to say?
It is. I mean, it's just like, dude.
Now, you're the head of design for Acura. You have a lot of young designers. Is there value here for them? Could you, if you could bring them out here, like, what would you point out to somebody who loves cars and doesn't know where to look because it's such an overwhelming experience?
It's an explosion. Absolutely. It is essential for them to come to things like this because all of the cues of car design have never changed. The proportion, the stance, you know, even wheel size, color, fabric, all of that, you can't miss any of it here. It's all so hand-built or craftsmanship and things like that. But I also think that just understanding the love of the car from all the people that are here, and you get them out here and say, let's walk around and look at, you know, this is what I like, what do you like? And it's always different. You know, I judged with, it was myself, two Brits, two Germans.
So you had Durheimer, you had Andy Palmer.
Yeah,
who's the other German?
Ian Callum.
And
who's my mind just went blank.
Reichman? No.
No, it was...
Sorry to trip you up.
No, Bugatti. Like it wasn't Aki.
Oh, Luke.
Yeah, but literally... We all agreed on the same thing. You know, it was like this, because maybe our age, maybe the stuff. But it was so funny because you're like, oh, hands down. We picked the Mercedes. You know, the Mercedes Coupe. That was, we were open, like, or people were open, and it was like, well, Ian says, let's rate them 1 to 10 as we go, and that was the last car we looked at, and it was like, okay, I'm changing my numbers and all the other ones because this is amazing.
Right.
But I mean, that's the thing about picking these cars, right? It's obvious once you see it.
Yeah.
That's the winner.
Yeah, and you know, you almost, I guess you could do it both ways, where you look at them at, you know, you spend 20 minutes, then you spend 20 minutes, or you could just go like this, and probably isn't as good because you immediately go, okay, that's one. Let's go back and talk about it, but that's it. So you could, you know, you hate to just cut to the chase, but a lot of times that's what happens. But in this case, what is different from all the other shows I usually judge was we really engaged the owner and said, you know, do you know how to – we actually had to show one of the owners how to open his hood vents because he didn't know how to do it. We're like, no, it's like this. But that part of it is really interesting to me that you end up learning more about the car than just the style. Or, you know, we did a Mercedes that was a Murphy body. And we were looking at the Germans were like, oh, my God. And I said, this is because Murphy would – they did all the Duesenbergs, and they didn't want a Mercedes to look better, so they made this thing. And they were like, oh. But, you know, you look at it and you think the history of why did they go to Murphy. But it turned out it was Vivian Leigh's car. And you know, it's like this actor kind of channel.
Right. So as we're sitting here talking, Jay's doing the very important function here every year at Pebble Beach. They're raffling off some cars and other prizes. And
did I win?
I don't think you won this time. And if you're not there to collect your prize, you could be in trouble. Oh no! It looks like here comes someone who's going to claim their prize.
Must be present.
Providing they don't trip over the fence.
But thank you for coming, Dave.
Yeah, absolutely. Anytime. Next time we'll talk about the new NSX.
Yeah, absolutely. What's going on. Hopefully you'll be driving across
here.
Yeah. Yes. Maybe I can drive it across the stage.
We're about to drive it soon anyway, aren't we?
Yes. Absolutely. Thank you
all
very
right.
much.
Well, thanks, Dave.
See you, man.
I heard you did great on your first time as a judge. They want you back.
I think once you're in, you're in.
You're right.
Thank you. So up next, and this is a real honor for me because this is a guy that was at my wedding. And we've been to Mexico together, Jamaica together. This is Conrad Stevenson. He's the lead judge for, I think, the post-war sports car class. He's also the guy. If you got an Alfa Romeo in California, Conrad will fix you up. How you doing, Conrad?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm doing good. So this is Ed. This is Angus.
Great to meet you, Ed.
Good to meet you.
Brought you here because you've been, how long have you been, how many years have you been a judge at Pebble?
I think about six. I first did it in 2005 when Alpha was a featured mark.
and was brought back to look at the 8C alphas when they did those.
And you actually, professionally, for your day job, that's what you do, is look at 8C alphas and Lancias and all kinds of Italian loveliness.
That's right. I can't get it out of my bones. And, you know, I probably prefer racing the cars and seeing cars in motion. But having restored cars and even shown here at Pebble, suffered some defeat doing that. But they asked me, and it's an honor, to see cars that they're preserved, or at least that's how we judge them. So
can I ask why my favorite Alpha 8C 2900, the Berlinetta, the blue one with the concentric dish wheels and the beautiful horizontal spats, didn't win again?
You have to choose new things once in a while. I might agree with you. Being a judge, for me, it's kind of intense and serious. I know the thousands of hours that go into preparing a car to show here. And we're given 15 minutes on the grass to look at them. But we study, I do, the cars, any literature we can get. The internet has helped tremendously, a resource to make better books. And there's, you know, it's an ongoing process. Some of the cars that we judge today may even be redone. That's not really answering your question, but that's where my head has been all day. So
we've had a number of honorary judges on here, but you're one of the serious guys. What are you looking for when you're judging a car? What is the stuff that scores?
That's right. We really look for the originality. That's what we're told, and authenticity. It's an elegance show is much easier to judge, and that's what the honorary judges can often look at. We look at every single detail. It's the smallest components, the hose clamps, the screw heads, the angles of the bodywork, that things haven't been altered from a period photo that we can find, something that's genuine to how the car was born. And that's what we look for as a Pebble Beach judge, which is, I would love to look at it and say, the most elegant car should win, but our criteria as judges are different. We can weigh in on the elegance, but it's really how it was born or near after. A car can be shown how it raced maybe 2 or 3 years later, and that's very valid.
Is there a subjective element to this? I mean, it's not just the pure objective, you know, if the color doesn't work or something like that.
Yes, we are given, after we total the car, which would be 100 points, and they're done in little 5-point increments. Pebble Beach has done a great job, and the Ferrari Club has helped really refine how we judge a car and how many points are given to a region. But at the end, we do have 3 elegance points to add, and that's often the tiebreaker. So while we are looking at those things, we do step back and look at it cleanly like that, the real elegance of a line, and try to weigh that in. And in the class that I judge, the post-war closed sports cars, Zagato body and Ghia bodied cars, fabulous cars, that's a big part of that.
So you did the Fiat, the 8Vs.
I did the 8V, the Maserati, the Ghia.
So there was one 8V, the Zagato was second, the
Ciata
was third. And the winner was
the Ghia Supersonic, which won here in 54, I believe, in its class, and really compromised bumper style on the car. But when you looked at photographs from that car show here, the restorers did a really fantastic job of absolutely replicating that. And, you know, gaudy bumpers and side pipes with a set screw and all these things that we would usually have a heart attack about as judges, so it looks so wrong, did super well.
The judges are still evaluating now, aren't they? Now we've had all the class winners.
That's right. They're now looking at the best in show.
And what's that like? What is that process like?
I've not been asked to do that yet, but I think that part is more subjective, and the honorary judges can be a part of that. So that they get to drop back. We've done, as the class judges, we've done our homework. It's authentic as much as we can tell, and like I said, but now they can really stand around and look at the cars and think, what's going to represent Pebble Beach this year? So last year we had our first post-war car win, which was wonderful, John Shirley's Ferrari. This year, who knows? We're right there.
So who gets to do that? Who, if not It's a separate set of judges within the wider pool?
That's right. There's a specific judges. I believe it's our lead judge. In this case, it would be Matt Stone, who was supervising our class. I was a team leader in my group. Supervising those cars, so there's a nice, you know, hierarchy of where you are, and it follows pretty well how it's selected. So yes, the team leaders, and I think some of the honorary judges, but I'm not specific on that. But yeah.
How do you feel this year was overall?
You know, it's great. I really focus so much on my class, and I put so much in, and we want to record notes so that the owners can come back to us, and we can, say, why did they not win? And, I think I'm prepared for that because you want to know. I wanted to know when I got third place why and how can we make it better. So I'm not able to really see the field. I'm so focused. And I did walk down, and then I go straight to race cars. That's where my heart is, you know, probably the Mexico Ferrari, you know, anything that really did something. So I'm excited. The Collies, Cunningham cars, great.
You just mentioned that, you know, you have notes to provide to the owners that didn't win. People get upset. I mean, do they come at you, or how does that like to tell them? I mean, you don't have to tell them bad news. They just know they didn't win.
It's a great question. I mean, I went home from here in tears, just saying.
Just so people know.
I entered, let's see, a 1900 Super Sport. I entered a Nardi Danese, the owners, but I was restoring them, right. And an Alfa Romeo Sprint Zagato, a long tail. And, you know, the judging was fair, but you can never prepare enough. Just like when I judge, I feel the same way of inadequacy. I do the best I can, but, you know, you want to get an A, but, you know, you don't know if you studied enough or too little. And same with showing a car. I always thought, though, in my experiences, the judging was fair, but it just beats you up. You work so hard. You're fatigued. You know, literally, I think a couple of those cars, I drove down in the middle of the night on a, you know, rinkety-dinkety trailer, and, you know, then sat on the grass, and then kind of got my butt kicked,
right.
And then drag yourself home. So it's really hard to, prepare completely for this event. And
typically, are the restorers more upset or the owners?
In general, it's just, I guess you did ask that question. You can see all that happening, having been here, and you just, the anguish. And I've really experienced that, and why a good reason not to do what I do. And I felt horrible about handing out maybe not a car, not even placing. And it might have just been that year, particularly, it was very close when I judged the 8C group in particular. I made a special trip back to Indianapolis to work absolutely every detail of an 8C Alpha, and when that was a really condensed group, it was down to the hose clamp font, the right plate, every single detail. And how original can you be? And, you know, we're looking at old black and white photos of the cars running in the Mille Miglia with Enzo Ferrari driving the thing. And, you know, that guy obviously thought the cars were so important to each of them, and these are multi-million dollar cars with very, and the emotions were just intense, and, you know, why people can be that successful. This show is like an embodiment of their success. They're preparing these cars just like they've done in their careers. They're very competitive people, and it's, you know, in some cases takes people years or lifetimes. They'll never get over the defeat. And
it's incredible that you guys actually go to that level of detail, like, you know, not only going on a trip to look at something, but like hose clamp font. I mean, how can the font be wrong on a hose clamp?
This is an obsessive compulsive convention. You know, we really are just here down to the, you know, the particulars. And it's wonderful, though. It threw me for a while, but I do think there's a place for that. And a really important thing to speak about that I feel that's why I'm actually doing this job is people would say, even after that, I'd meet with them and actually have lunch after I was given permission to do that and still talk them down off the window ledge that, you know, it's okay. And they're back now, some of those owners that didn't win. But we want to improve the cars. We're about originality and authenticity, and that's where we go. And also, we're big thing that Pebble Beach is going for is not over restoring the cars, which for a long time, this was all about chrome and bling, and maybe even that Supersonic that had those big chrome bumpers, and, you know, might have been the beginning of that. And in my lifetime, I've seen it to where the Europeans, when I would go to Italy, I've run in the Mille Miglia, and they would say, "Oh, an American car. It's over restored. It's all chrome and shiny." And I think for a long time, the Americans have now caught up and even come back, and Pebble Beach is actually more about
deducting for over-polished things and getting back to that. And the Ferrari Owners Club, again, very specific about that, really noticing the fine details. And this is the event to do that. Other events are, you know, super great events and very good and very important, aren't about that. And it's about elegance. And I'd also add that it's really, that's still a place for cars that don't have all that minutia here at Pebble Beach. It's fine to not win and show a car. And in some of the cars I did show, the 1900s, we ran without the bumpers in a racing configuration that we knew we would take a deduction. And a paint scheme that wasn't original, but it was darned elegant, and people liked it. And, you know, your car was beautiful, maybe the most beautiful on the lawn, and placed third, or, you know, which was good considering the deductions we took. And I still encourage people, and good sportsmanship is certainly abounds here. I mean, many people do take it well, some don't.
So what's your view on the preservation class? This is a relatively new thing, and is it simply that this is patina that money can't buy?
Yes, I think I love preservation. I mean, I still think maybe you should wash your car before you bring it to a car show. But some of that dirt is pretty good dirt, and that's really valid. You know, this Paris collection, I think that we saw here, you know, it's really significant. And I think that a word that's used is some people restore the life out of cars. And that's a really important thing. And a preservation race car like a Cunningham or an E-Type Jaguar or Ferrari with the cracked leather seat, to me, trumps everything if it's real. It speaks about it. The bugs on the windshield. I think that's really absolutely top in my book. So I would say that's, you know, I like the preservation. It's certainly, I feel we can weigh that in with the chrome and the full restorations. But they're generally different class, and it is apples and oranges.
Talking with the owners, the striking thing I noticed was, I mean, these are guys who run businesses. They're used to, you know, getting what they want or what they need or and making it happen. And some of them are. I was surprised at the depth of emotion that came from them when they started talking about A, their car being chosen to be in Pebble Beach, and B, you know, the possibility that they might win an award. I mean, it struck me that this was something these people cared deeply about.
It is. It's really emotional. I think, you know, we
so you're getting emotional. You were talking about the cars that you entered.
Yes. And also for owners and the cars. And they often, you know, there's so many pasts and people that worked on the cars and owners. All cars have this embodiment of the owners that have owned them before. And it's very emotional to have a car. I mean, I raced a car yesterday that I had a great deal with a man that's no longer here, and you just think of that person looking down on you, and if that's the case, and it is. It's easy to get teared up about a car, and I do. It's weird, and I kind of, why am I starting to cry?
We all get it.
Yeah, I know. We're here at this convention.
Can we ask what you raced yesterday?
I raced a 39 Alpha 6C 2500 Super Sport in the pre-war group.
Wow. That's pretty cool. Conrad, by the way, I don't know if I said this earlier, but hell of a driver. I mean, like, one of my, you know, favorite moments is doing donuts in Jalen's parking lot. He took their Lemons car, which was a 71 Spider that you put a 59 nose on. And this guy did, like, perfect donuts for, I don't know, 5 minutes, and it was incredible.
I'm still ashamed. But I think that what's great is that cars should be playful. I mean, I don't think we would have had this many diverse designs that are here without people having fun with it. And race car was this natural evolution of creating shapes that worked and still happening. We still see different cars that are going to Le Mans and Formula One constantly changing. I mean, to people that see the details, they are evolving, and that's what we see from the 1910 car to the, you know, 2015 car up on the lawn. And it's wonderful. And I like having a good time with cars, and this is an aspect that I think is important, but I like the broad spectrum of grassroots racing. I think that's where I'm from, and like to see a creative element always. If I can't be creative, I'll quit what I'm doing.
So
I don't want to just restore.
So the judges are still obviously deliberating. Jay Leno still out there running a raffle. He does pretty good. He could get a job on television, couldn't he?
Yeah.
Jackie Stewart there, of course, legendary three-time World Formula One champion with his tartan cap on.
And pants. Don't forget the pants.
The trues. But I'd just like to get some thoughts on the class winners that we've seen and some favorites on potentially on best of show. I mean, I think some of us have seen the Isotta Fraschini as being a very strong contender. Does that...
I certainly think it divides people. I think those eras, you've seen more than I have. I like, you know, I come a little later. I do like the 30s cars. I like, you know, the Alpha Touring choice. Hard for me to say.
Do you have a favorite, though? Do you have one that you saw that said that should win?
The Alpha Touring.
I did say that, and I'm with you too. The 2.9, why didn't that? So you're only eligible for best in show if you win your class. So those didn't, and they've won before. I don't think we try to be creative, but you know, cars that look elegant just might not have had, you know, the right motor or the right finish, so they lost out. So that's, they're not part of that. There's other awards they can get by the select committee, but. I don't really. I'm sorry. And I shouldn't say if I knew. So, I mean, I can't.
No, you can't. I know you can't. But Ed and Johnny, have you changed your mind? Anything you've seen?
You know, that I saw just being so rare, I think. You've never seen something like that. There was the only one out here. I don't.
The three that I was going through beforehand, I thought that the Azada for sure. I think the Frenet Delahaye, which also won. Yeah. I thought it was incredibly strong, and I don't know if it was eligible, but it didn't win, but there was that blue, there was a 250 short wheelbase, sea blue Ferrari, California, and just the loveliest thing,
the Frenet Coupe could be a strong car. I mean, that I hadn't seen up close until today, and that's a very strong car.
It is, but I just wonder, you know, it is kind of, it was a Grand Prix car, and then it became this. I just got to wonder if the provenance is right. Maybe it's exactly right, or maybe, maybe the 1924 the Azada is, maybe it's too stereotypical for a pebble car. But that said, it's one of those, the second you see it, it's like that. Your car makes sense.
You're probably onto something there.
And I,
that's right. I mean, we had the post-war, so it's hard to say. I'm from that era. I mean, I like the late 30s. So the French cars, I like the French curves. I think someone said something about an accelerating curve that the human eye is just attracted to it. And I'm guilty of that. You know, the curves and the lines, and when I go to a more vertical line, I have trouble with that, even including, like, now we're seeing it again in new car design where they're edgier and sharper, and it just doesn't appeal to me personally. And the judges, we all, when we're chosen, we get to do what we want. We've been selected as judges, so it can be a personal decision to choose what it is, and we'll see how the judges weigh out on that.
It'll be interesting to see. I mean, I think we're coming to a generational inflection point here at Pebble Beach. I mean, for years now, the European, the J1 and J2 classes have provided the bulk of winners. The American classics have been another fertile ground, and the Duesenbergs, another fertile ground. I thought last year's win was a breakthrough, and maybe a bellwether for how the Concours is going to go.
I think absolutely. I mean, as judges get younger, that's going to happen. How can we keep, what cars excite the next generations, I think should be reflected in what we're doing. We shouldn't just always be the past generation. And it's sometimes sad to think that those cars that we all looked at, the Cords and Duesenbergs and Auburns, were Packards, were these wonderful things, and they still are. And I'm sure they'll always have a place at Pebble. But I was excited by a P3 racing Ferrari, and I think that's super elegant. I just can't help myself. It's impulsive. It's like something that I lust after. It hits me very hard as a male, or I don't know, a person that wants to race a car and drive it really hard. Super excites me, and I think it's extraordinarily beautiful. Yet it's a, you know, to other people, it's a crazy racing car. You know, nothing you drive around on the beach, but. We'll see what generations hold, if they want something that's just beautiful and elegant to share a lifestyle and have a picnic in, or something that's purely a speed form. on steroids with a V12 motor. I think those things at least fired me, and if there's other people like me, I think that may be coming. I don't know.
Maybe one last question for you. We haven't seen each other in a little bit, but you were working on a Bonneville land speed car, one of our last conversations. It was a couple of years ago. Is there any progress on that? There was an alpha-based, or maybe you were taking the Lemons car and going to put a aerodynamic body on it?
I did that, yes.
Oh, you did?
But, yeah, I did. I converted our 71 Alpha into what I call a Tipo, a dirty 3 or cheapo 33, but it's put a 164 motor in it and did the body work on it. Again, just being playful. I think it's good to just as an exercise, you know, throw out some wire forms and bend sheet metal and hammer it together. And also I'm working, I have my own, maybe the special project that I also, I started drawing cars in high school, so now I'm making a V8 powered mid-engine car, alpha powered mid-engine car that I've been designing, so maybe that's what it was.
What's the ETA on that?
Yeah, before I die. The Lemons car is good, though, and I built a Mexico car, same sort of thing, just built whole body, so I really enjoy the shaping and all elements that go into a car, so it's been exciting and fun, so
great.
I'm still having a good time.
Good, and thanks so much. It's really
pleasure.
real treat to get
thanks
that
so
kind of the inside baseball.
Good to see you, Johnny.
Thanks,
Conrad. So as we get ready for getting down towards the business end of the day here at Pebble Beach, where, of course, Best of Show will be announced. But first we have a few Elegance Awards coming along, and the cars are being wrangled as we speak. But let's just have a look back at what we thought were the contenders, and we've been joined by MotorTrend Technical Director Frank Marcus. Frank, hi.
Hello.
Hello.
Have you had a good day?
An excellent day.
Great.
I just want to say, for a technical director, that is a lovely tie.
And I've got my colored pants on, too.
Which match my hat.
Yeah. It really turned out here.
Well, as we're watching, this is the 1902 Panhard from... It's a fantastic car. It looks like your looks like a shed on wheels, actually.
I think that's the oldest car here, correct?
I think it is.
Frank, what we've talked a lot about winners, potential winners. Please tell me what your top three for Best in Show would be. But then also I want to hear what your personal favorite is.
See, that's the thing. I would be no good as a judge here. I don't tend to like the cars that they pick for the winners. So quite often I haven't even taken a photograph of the car that wins.
Okay, so then what are your top three favorites on the lawn then?
Top three. I mean, I tend to gravitate to the cars from my period.
Absolutely.
So those Fiat Autoveuse, the 8Vs, are really, plus the very unusual things you don't see every day. That, there's a Pegaso out there.
Of course. We called it. We said, Frank's going to love this Pegaso.
From my day driving that car, that's a real high favorite. Yeah.
It was very funny because Ed and I were walking by and
the car just on the ramp at the moment is the winner of the FIVA pre-war trophy, and it's a 1921 Stutz Bearcat, and it's a fabulous preservation class car. And of course we talked about that before, Stutz Bearcat, what a name. And you listen to it, it sounds
like a Bearcat.
Yeah, and that's real patina there. I'm all for genuine patina. There's a black Ferrari out there that's just dirty.
That's my personal favorite. That 61 short wheelbase California Spider with a big dent in the back.
So we've asked a lot of different people, should they have washed it or not? It's been split. It's been split.
No. So coming up on the ramp now is the winner of the Lincoln Trophy, which not surprisingly is a Lincoln. This one's a 1933 Lincoln KB Dietrich 5-passenger convertible sedan. And Frank, weren't Lincoln something back in those days?
They were right up there with Cadillacs and Packards and even Rolls Royces back in the day. That is a spectacular car.
This one was actually one of the ones before I kind of got to the J classes that I thought, and Dietrichs tend to be the most elegant of all of them, but I said maybe this has a shot because that Dietrich won 2 years ago.
Yeah.
And that was a very obvious, saw that, I was like, oh, come on, baby.
Right.
But this, I think this is a real special car.
Yeah, coach built, those were the way to go in the day. V12, the more cylinders, the better.
And when you're doing something interesting where you were trying to find technical innovation as our technical director.
Yeah.
So tell us that story.
Yeah, so I gravitated to cars that either like set land speed records. There were a couple of cars that were the first passenger car to go 100 miles an hour for 24 hours of an old Renault 45, enormous car. Actually, the chassis was the one that did that. This was a different body. That it was an Auburn Boattail Speedster that had another 100 mile an hour for a period of time. A.B. Jenkins did that one. So there's a car with a tubular chassis and four-wheel disc brakes, an Atalanta, very cool car, never even heard of. So, you know, the war kind of scuppered that effort. So.
And the car on the ramp at the moment is the recipient of the Alec Ullman Trophy for the most exciting Hispano Suiza here. And it is, of course, a Hispano Suiza from 1929, an H6B Hibbard and Darren Cabriolet de Ville. In other words, a cabriolet for the city and a town car by another description.
They never rendered that whole name in chrome, did they?
No. But Hispanos are one of the iconic big luxury brands. And that's a very representative Hispano.
Frank, this is, I assume, is the Renault you were talking about,
is.
Which is
Speaking
the size of a bus, devil, but gorgeous.
The chassis and 9-liter engine alone weigh 4,000 pounds. So.
I love the picture of that bodywork ad.
These are gorgeous. I love these Renaults. They were
the 1920s.
All these cars are hard to distinguish, but that nose is obviously a Renault.
Yes, a 1926 Renault 45 MC Minucius Cabriolet de Ville. The fascia on the Renault, the hood that came over the front, it's very distinctive.
Totally.
They tried to reinvent it, didn't they, with several modern cars, but it's never...
Yep.
Never had quite the same grandeur.
But those and like Pierce Arrows, and there's a few that even a novice should be able to pick out from a distance.
I would also say you were saying you weren't necessarily excited by the older cars, but like I love this. It gets my blood boiling. Like, it's just, like, such a just a
9-liter,
yes,
six cylinder,
yes, just a Goliath, a juggernaut. Yeah. I love these things. And the scale, sometimes size does matter.
Yeah, and of course it's 40 or 45, you know, road horsepower they talk about. You know, pound feet of torque is for four digits.
Right.
But, you
know. And it spins in the three digits, right?
Oh, now we're talking.
This is getting my blood boiling.
Yeah.
The 1953 Cunningham C5R Roadster, of course, wins the Briggs Cunningham Trophy. And I don't know. I still like the C4R. So I like the one with the air intake up there and the little cutaway at the front. That to me is my favorite Cunningham race car. But iconic always with the white with the racing blue stripes.
Did you see that peculiar green one at the end, the prototype that looked like a small car that had been made 1.5 times size or something, overinflated?
Look at the profile there. It's just,
yeah,
it's just,
this is really stunning, is actually. Yeah, this is quite great. Quite great.
Nobody was using wind tunnels, but you can see this looks shaped by the wind a little bit.
That's what I love about it. You know, we saw the like the D-types where they have that cutout for the head along with the wing that goes back, and it's like, yeah, we think this will work. You know, we're not really sure. I talked to another guy. It had the roll bar hoop, and on it was the spoiler. He said to keep the back down, but then also another weird winglet fixed position to draw air into the oil cooler. And it's like, we didn't know whether it worked or not, but this is what we did back then.
Give it a shot, why not?
Why not? What are you going to do?
Well, I was not saying if it looked right, it usually was.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're probably all fans of aircraft as well. And if you look at the, you know, the Supermarine Spitfire in World War II, I mean, just the most elegant looking plane. And it flew pretty well, too. So Jaguar guys talked about back in the day, you know, with the XJ13 and cars like that, they weren't really aerodynamically tested. Yeah. It was all done by eye.
No, we learned that the 1959 Chevy was one of the first bodies that they did any aero work on, but after the fact, not during the design phase.
At General Motors, that is.
Well, I know that the E-Type, which is kind of considered the most beautiful car in the world, they did have a wind tunnel. Couple problems with it. One was it used so much energy that they had to do it after everyone went to bed. So they would go to the pub and wait. They were kind of drunk once they'd start looking at the results. And then they'd try, you know, they were taping cotton to it, seeing which was more. They didn't know what a wind tunnel did, but it came out perfect.
I've long loved this car. The recipient of the Tony Holman Trophy, the 1948 Talbot Largo T26C Grand Prix Racer. I think from memory, my dad had a slot car version of one of those. I just love the exhaust pipes coming out the side there, the louvers on the bonnet, like Ian Callum. I'm a big fan of louvers. And of course, Grand Prix cars of that era, it was kind of transitional between pre-war and post-war. It's much lower. It reminds you of the pre-war Silver Arrows Benzes, but somehow a little more elegant in the French blue.
This one's pretty.
Yes.
Well, Frank, you're the Maserati guy.
Give us
the skinny. Yeah. What do we got here with this one?
Well, I can't see it coming up yet.
It's the 1955 Maserati A6G 2000 Zagato Coupe. It's the winner of the Art Center College of Design Award.
And being a Zagato, of course, you would expect to see the double bubble roof on it, but they seem to have resisted the urge to do that feature.
And just like Ed was talking about that Cunningham, I mean, the profile of this looks so right.
Yeah.
I love just big coupes like that, the fastbacks. And, you know, it's funny now today, who's doing this? Rolls-Royce, the Wraith has this.
And it looks like it's been chopped, you know, hot rod style, but that's the factory Zagato roofline.
You know, it's great even for the fans who aren't familiar with this car or not from this era. You can look. This is what's so great about having these extant brands that reach so far back. I hope they show a front shot of it, but you can see in the grill, you know, the Trident, just the shape of it, which is echoed now in some of the modern designs, even on a sedan. You know, this is history.
Yeah, that single tooth in the middle is a real hallmark.
And it's one of the great logos, isn't it? That Trident, of course.
Absolutely.
And what's also great with Zagato is that when they do get it right, man, back up, because nobody gets it that right. Just unbelievable coach builders.
So here's another Invicta. This is the winner of the Montague of Bewley Trophy, 1931 Invicta LS Car Bodies Coupe. And, of course, Lord Montague of Bewley is a great British classic car collector. Yeah. And again, the Invicta with the underslung chassis.
Yeah, very low.
So this was my pick for the Invicta class, the one that actually wound up, not the Invicta class, but the class I was in. The white one was on the tour. But look at this thing. The side profile is incredible. I mean, it's sinister, you know, and again, Angus, dash to axle. There it is, all the dash.
And everything was so tall those days that anything underslung looked really impressive.
Look, it's funny, what Conrad said about an accelerating line, a fast sloping line versus he has a problem with the vertical, and I get what he's saying. That windshield is so upright, it's just...
But it's pushed back far enough that you have enough hood.
Yeah, it doesn't look racy. Even though it's got the length and the width, that uprightness is like a wall.
The profile there, not great.
That's why they chopped it. You know, yeah. Tiny. I love that look.
It was great to see Invicta here because it's one of those brand. You know, you read about it. That, as I said, the other car that we saw, Donald Healey drove it in the Monte Carlo Rally. That Invicta Type S. And I always remember seeing the photographs when I was a kid of the cars on the dirt roads being slid around and covered in mud. I thought they look kind of cool.
Very cool looking cars. I think, you know, and again, we were talking, you know, is this going to do for, you know, Invicta and DuPont what the lawn did for Ruxton? You know, last year it's kind of darling.
Yeah.
But it's great to see Invicta. You know, again, it's an obscure car I've kind of loved from a distance for a while, but it's great to see it get some major exposure. So
it's fascinating to contemplate again, you know, all the brands that have disappeared. And, you know, we talked about it at one point, you know, between 1900 and 1908, 485-odd companies started building cars. And you think about how many of them are left in the United States now.
Right. Totally different business then. There were all these engine builders. You could just buy these various parts and assemble them. And, of course, it was difficult to transport the cars, so building them locally in places for immediate consumption made sense. So.
And just we freak out now when a car manufacturer shutters, or you know, when Pontiac went away, or Hummer, or Saab. People are just going crazy.
Right, that was a daily, hourly occurrence back then.
You know, start and hold, but it does illustrate how important a brand is and why, when a brand is teetering on the brink, a lot of investors come in and poke at it and look over because
is there value here?
There's absolutely, because you have this history you can mine, but you also have a distribution network, a retail channel, that all that stuff, if you want to start from scratch in this day and age, impossible. It's not like the start
of top of mind in people. That's why, I mean, how long did Saab name sort of sit there idling in neutral before it got picked up?
Exactly.
But surely the costs of the business these days is just impossible to take a chance on that now. You really got to be very certain of what you're going to do.
And
well financed. I think, for example, we're seeing the return of Alfa Romeo to North America shortly. And, you know, I'm an Alfa owner. I have a 1967 awaiting restoration GTV. And it kind of saddens me a bit that Alfa Romeo, back in the late 50s, early 60s, it was like BMW was. They did fine sporting sedans and coupes. And now the range is basically, apart from the 4C, there's a couple of hatchbacks. Now they've got the new Giulia coming, but I worry, is it going to be a day late and a dollar short? Because the last time Alfa Romeo pricked the psyche of the general American populace, you know, Dustin Hoffman was just out of acting school.
Right.
So just having a great brand name is one thing.
And they have to hope that
why should anyone care?
That everyone's remembering the graduate and not the 164s that we last had experience with, because those were not splendid.
Right.
So here we have, coming up onto the ramp, the Revs program at Stanford Award, the 1914 Rolls-Royce Silver Ghost Kellner Torpedo Phaeton.
And it's a double.
A lovely car, Rolls-Royce. I mean, it's fascinating, isn't it? This is a brand that's consistently been a luxury brand. And I think the way that it started was that the focus was so much on engineering excellence. Henry Royce, the cars were expensive to build, so only the wealthy could afford to buy the cars. And I think then what propagated Rolls-Royce to perhaps the expense of some brands like Packard was, of course, the remnants of the British Empire meant that Rolls-Royce was sold all around the world through Asia, Australia,
India,
and other parts of the world.
You know, we remember the Maharaja class from a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
Last night at the Bentley party, I talked to the number one Rolls-Royce salesperson in the U.S., and she told me a lot of very interesting facts about Rolls-Royce buyers, their behavior, and the market that she's in. And I was talking to Johnny about this, so he knows the answers. Any guesses as to, she's not the number one, she doesn't sell in the number one region, she's in the number three region, but she's the number one salesperson for Phantoms. Where does she sell her cars, do you think?
The most Phantoms in the U.S. And it's obvious once Ed tells you the answer, which is?
Connecticut?
No.
Palm Desert, Palm Springs.
Wow.
Of course.
Number one market is Miami. Second is Beverly Hills. Third would be Palm Desert. And fascinating. She said she has to know the specs of the vehicles upside down and backwards because people assume because she's a woman, she won't know it. But then she actually sells them on the other aspects of the car, the tradition, the history, the luxury, and the specs.
It's funny though. Any of them by the bespoke ordering process, or are they all just off the lot?
Because we're greedy Americans. We want to walk in the dealership and buy the white one. But she does do some ordering when she knows like who the customer is when they come in. But it was fascinating. And the funniest thing she said is that, you know, when a guy comes into the dealership wearing a suit, he's not buying something, he's selling you something. It's the guy who comes in the sweatpants and the sneakers that's probably going to drop the $300,000, $400,000 to pick up the Wraith or the Phantom. And a nice watch can go either way.
And here's
my car. This is my favorite. This is one I shot should have won. This is that Alfa Romeo.
2900
Berlinetta. I just love, for me, it's the elegance that just goes, just that step above the chrome, the double sphere that goes all the way across. not wire wheels. It's got concentric circle dish wheels, the vertical, you know, detail in the spats, and the louvers.
Remember former Best of Show winner.
2008 Best of Show winner. I thought I could do it again. Everybody picked the white one next to it, which also is a fantastic car. But I think you said dash to axle on this one. Right?
Oh, yeah. I mean,
well, this one's just taken the Strother McMinn Most Elegant Sports Car Award. So, Ed, you're a man with taste.
Yes, that thing's phenomenal.
So this back is to Rolls-Royce for a second, that we're talking about brand perception. Remember, back then, you know, Charles Royce was a Minerva dealer. Minerva was the big luxury car, and then Cadillac, Packard. Rolls was sort of a peg down. And they've become more luxurious.
This thing's awesome, too, though.
Is this one of the contenders for best of show?
I think this is, in my opinion, this is one of the top two. Probably a Ferrari's going to sneak in there also, but the Frenet and the Azada are going to be very close.
I'd love to know what this thing's like to drive. Have you seen how short the wheelbase is and all that V12 power? I got to wonder if it's kind of a handful if you ever tried.
I don't think anyone tries. No. This car's just won the Gwen Graham Most Elegant Convertible Award.
This is the Grand Prix car.
The sound. I hope everyone can hear the sound of this thing when it fires up. It is phenomenal.
It's not a surprise that it's a Grand Prix car when they fire it up.
Yeah, but supposedly it was beating Silver Arrows back in the 30s. And then they did this to it, and it's just a fabulous design. I mean, it's, you can't argue.
Gatsby-esque. Look at that thing.
So this is the winner of the JB and Dorothy Nethercutt Most Elegant Car Award, I think we're seeing now. It's
this was the car Hurley was talking about. This is the Italian Rolls-Royce.
Yes, the 1932 Rolls-Royce Phantom II Continental with bodywork by Fagoni and Falaschi.
It's a strange car because, you know, it's got the size and scale of the Rolls, but then you have the beautiful English wheel hammered metal that, you know, like from the teardrop cars.
And with the British heritage, it is the most demure and toned down thing Fagoni and Falaschi ever managed to do.
Rolls-Royce really is a remarkable brand. I mean, I forget what percentage of Rolls-Royce ever built is still on the road. It's something like 80%. And it's not necessarily that the cars do low miles. A lot of them do very high mileage. Some of these older cars, I mean, you know, down in Australia, you heard stories of wealthy sheep farmers using them to go, you know, collect hay bales. Lawrence of Arabia, of course, used Rolls-Royce built on armored cars built on silver ghost chassis in the Middle East in World War I, going across the desert. And he said, in, you know, military terms, those cars were more valuable than rubies, which is a great quote.
This is a striking car.
It is. And the grill work. People need to know the you know, the technical specs on the grill, how they have to, their angle at a certain way, so that if you do line work and it's actually even, it looks uneven. So there's a special arrangement of the slats to make it actually look like they're perfectly straight up and down and parallel in the entire grill form.
Well, that's why the Wraith was sort of such a big deal. I think it was the first Rolls-Royce ever, including the Fagoni, that had a curved grill. It actually swept, and it was like, you know, the Rolls purists, like, oh, how could you do this?
The Parthenon is blowing down.
Right. But it turns out that's going to be their best-selling car ever by a factor of a lot, you know. So.
Well, there was the famous road test in Autocar magazine in 1907. They tested the Rolls-Royce Silver Ghost, and I was so impressed with its smoothness and silence and its durability. I mean, roads were pretty rough back then, that they dubbed it the best car in the world, and that probably is the first time a magazine quote has been used in advertising, because Rolls-Royce certainly ran with that for a long time. But at one stage, when I worked in Britain, I worked in a town called Peterborough, and just outside of there is Al Walton, where Henry Royce was born. And he was the real fanatic in Rolls-Royce. He was Charles Rolls was the showman and one of the first Englishmen killed in an air crash, I think.
Very special favorite from
that Henry Royce was the Martin that made the cars be perfectly built together. I think we're getting ready now for the best of the best of show. We're coming very close.
If I could ask all of you for that favor, does that work? Yeah. No,
there's not very
convincing
looks. We've got four car.
Okay.
Derek's asking the assembled media and the fans not to bum rush the stage because.
Okay, so let's cut over and see what's going on. Sandra Derek Hill is going to take us through the nominees for the Best of Show award. Coming out is Sandra Button.
The Best of Show ballots have been collected and the Best of Show nominees have now been assembled. So to my left, you can see those truly elegant cars from which the Best of Show will be identified. And the nominees are Doug McGee from Wolfboro, New Hampshire in the 1914 Rolls-Royce. Grant Kinzel from Calgary, Canada in a 1953 Abarth 110. 1100. Jim Patterson from Louisville, Kentucky in a 1924 Isotta Fraschini. Sam and Emily Mann from Englewood, New Jersey, their 1937 Delahaye. Ladies and gentlemen, there is only one Best of Show, and to reveal what car and owner will take home that title and honor, we turn to our chairman, Sandra Button. Sandra, the envelope, please. The 65th annual Pebble Beach Concours d'Elegance Best of Show winner is the 1924 Isotta Fraschini Tipo 8, Jim Patterson, Louisville, Kentucky. Presenting this award is, I'll say it once again, there's a lot of music there. Bill Pierocki, the CEO of the Pebble Beach Company. Presenting the gift certificate for a photograph of the Best of Show car, which will be mounted in a custom leather portfolio, is Michael Furman of Coach Built Press. Incredible moment for Mr. Patterson. The amount of time and commitment that goes into winning these Best of Shows, you have no idea. What a beautiful car. It's 1924 Isotta Fraschini.
Isotta Fraschini. I mean, Johnny, you're pretty happy with that.
this is the third year out of five that I've called the best of show, and the other two the one I called first was third, and the other one was second. So my very good record becomes much better. So I am.
Once again, I do not have a picture of this car, but I do like the when I was five, I had my mom make a birthday cake of an Isuzu Fraschini. So I have been aware of the brand forever.
I'm not gonna lie, I had no idea about this car. I asked Kim Reynolds about 5 minutes before our production meeting, "What do you think he's gonna win?" He said, "I think that Isuzu Fraschini has a really good chance. That Delahaye, he picked three out of the four." And I said,
there is a certain style to a Pebble Beach Best of Show car, and I thought the Delahaye was in there potentially, but that has the extravagance, the size that really works so well here,
and the elegance. I mean, really the elegance, and well won. And these judges are very smart people, obviously.
But it is a beautiful car. No post-war car this year. I don't think that was on the cards anyway after the Ferrari winning last year. So I think probably reasonably predictable, though it was good to see in the final four nominees a good breadth of cars. So we had not only the Isotta and the Delahaye, we had the 1914 Rolls-Royce, and of course the little 1950s Fiat Abarth with that amazing body.
I was totally pulling for that one. I mean, what a David versus Goliath. That guy restored that himself, painted it in his one-car garage. I mean, that was an amazing little car.
It was. That said, this is the Best of Show winner, and it really is the best thing here at the show.
What Conrad said was after the Ferrari winning last year, this year becomes kind of the mark to be out on the lawn. There's going to be a lot of invitees, and I think that's kind of a hedge against another post-war Ferrari winning, is that you invited them all anyways. You're not going to pick 2 years in a row the same.
That might be part of the problem, is that is there a post-war brand that has the strength of Ferrari, another one. And
Porsche could make it. If you start picking race cars, you have to include them. Mercedes.
Yeah, Mercedes definitely, but
just an incredible amount of,
you know, you could go this way, go that way. It means something, doesn't mean something. I just think that I looked at every car here, and this I thought was the most elegant car on the lawn, and it won, so.
And it was on the Tour d'Elegance, so that car actually, he took it out and drove it, and when we were in Carmel, where everyone pulls in, and literally you're on the main street there, Ocean Street in Carmel, there's thousands of people milling around, and you'd think, oh my God, you know, you wouldn't want someone to lean up against the car and scratch it. There's the owner Jim Patterson enjoying some champagne.
I really wish they would do the Formula One winning thing and just shake a huge bottle of champagne.
I wish someone would bring us a bottle of champagne. It's about that time.
Well, as they celebrate there on the stand, and the Best of Show winners about to go to the interviews, a very, very happy owner there. We've enjoyed bringing you coverage of the 65th Pebble Beach Concours d'Elegance live from the lawn here at the lodge at Pebble Beach on the beautiful Monterey Peninsula in California. Thank you very much for watching. We'll be back next year. In the meantime, please catch our highlight show on CBS Sports Network Wednesday, August 26. Check your local listings for details. On behalf of Ed Lowe, Johnny Lieberman, Frank Marcus, our guests, the whole team at the Enthusiast Network, thanks for watching and goodbye.